Thank you for coming to the January 26, 2016 school committee meeting. This evening, we really just have one agenda item, one of the most important we tackle all year, and it's the FY 2018 budget. Before that, however, I am going to invite public comment. Generally speaking, public comment happens when we hit the agenda item, so I would ask if you would like to speak to the FY 2018 budget that you wait till we get to that. It will happen very quickly. That's pretty much our only agenda item. However, two groups, I should say, have specifically asked due to time constraints if they could speak right at the outset of the meeting, and I'm going to allow that. So we're going to have public comment in just a moment. Obviously, if you're here to discuss something that isn't the budget, this is also the right time to raise your hand. So we'll do that. We have a quick consent agenda. I am going to do reports tonight because I have one for the committee, and then we're going to delve into the budget, and that is it. That is the focus for this evening. So, gentlemen, I'd like to ask you to kick us off. I believe you want to address the committee. Okay, I'm going to ask you to step over to that microphone. This is being taped by RCTV, and we want everyone to hear it when it's recorded for the record.
Dear fellow citizens of Reading,
we're here tonight to discuss the matters of budget cuts.
As you well know, it has been proposed that we cut middle school foreign language classes, as well as the second period of English Language Arts, ELA for short, in sixth grade.
We believe that these changes will not help the students of Reading learn and grow.
Learning another language beyond our own very own is important not only to children, but to adults as well. When children learn a new language, they understand and respect the culture in a new way.
Learning as a child, you have better memory and can remember and learn things easier than someone in high school.
Also, when these children grow up, their job options are greatly expanded. They could become a broadcast journalist, a diplomatic services operational officer, an English foreign language teacher, an international aid and development worker, logistics and distribution manager, etc.
Not only does it affect our jobs, but others as well. Jobs today are based around the world, and with the access to the internet, we have become a world marketplace. The importance of having a knowledge base of other languages not only helps but improves our ability to communicate. A reason to keep foreign languages in second period ELA is because that ELA is a very important subject.
Learning the English language is vital to the development of students. A second language benefits the learner in many ways, including
open a world of job opportunities, gives your brain an intellectual challenge, establishes deep connections and cross-cultural friendships, gets an outside perspective about your own culture, becomes a better learner, increases the student's mental focus, reading and writing abilities, mathematics in school as well.
It also affects the ability to think critically in different environments. It enhances listening and memory. It provides a competitive edge in career choices. And 4 out of 5 jobs in the U.S. are created as a result of cultural trade.
Speaking a foreign language improves the functionality of your brain by challenging it to recognize, negotiate meaning, and communicate in different language systems. This skill boosts your ability to negotiate meaning and other problem-solving tasks as well.
The potential elimination of foreign language in middle school affects me because my goal in life is to be a teacher or marine biologist. As you know, the ocean covers 2/3 of the world, so I would have to be bilingual. If I learn foreign language later in high school, I would have less of an opportunity to have an impact.
My goal in life is to attend MIT, and I need to have an educated experience in foreign languages to attend. If I start learning a foreign language in 8th or 9th grade, I won't remember all that I need to enter MIT.
When I graduate high school, going to college will be a top priority for me. If I maintain a high GPA and do well on my SAT, I will need all the help I can get admitted to a decent school. A quick Google search will show you all the research done correlating accepted college applications with foreign language.
We strongly support an override and are committed to promoting it to the community. Thank you for your time. Au revoir.
Wait, before you get up. Share your name and your age and what school you go to.
I'm Brody Walter. I go to Coolidge and I'm in 7th grade.
I'm Zachary Nichols. I also go to Coolidge in 7th grade.
I'm Bill Walter and I also go to Coolidge in 7th grade.
Thank you so much.
Nice job, Kat.
Yeah, it was amazing. Your parents must be so insanely proud of you. I'm proud of you, and I just met you. yeah, you're a credit to the school system. Thank you. Thank you for coming here tonight. Don't ever think your voice wasn't heard. I heard every word you said. We all heard every word you said, and it is so important that you came up and spoke. So thank you. Thanks for being here. Mr. Berman, I don't envy you following that. I don't think you can be half as articulate as they just were.
What do they say? Never follow kids and animals. I'm Barry Berman, member of the Board of Selectmen, and I appreciate you taking me out of order because I have to have another commitment after this, so I'm just going to make my remarks, and then unfortunately I have to leave, but I'm RCTV. I watch this when I can't sleep at night. And so I just wanted to say, last night at the Financial Forum, I shared with you what keeps me up at night, and I want to share with you tonight about what kept me up last night. After the Financial Forum, we heard, and you know, no one said it better than these three lads. I wish we had them door to door in the last override. I think we wouldn't be struggling as much as we are. So, fellas, make yourselves available. The fight is not over. So, I thought about it last night, about especially, and I think it was one of the residents who I think may also have been a school teacher or a counselor, sort of went through it and just sort of basically. After a lot of people talked about, you know, the devastation of what these cuts are going to mean, basically looked at the five of us and, you know, Mr. Amina, myself, and my three colleagues, said, "So, what are you going to do about it?" And so, realizing that there's five people in the town of Reading that have the ability to at least keep this moving forward, and you know, around 3 o'clock in the morning, I decided what I was going to do about it. And so what I wanted to share with you and the community at large is that I am prepared to propose and to support in the spring an override, reduced in magnitude, obviously from last time, for a shorter duration to restore the cuts. And I'm prepared to fight for that and work with everybody here. There's a couple of things, though, before I can actually go out and do that definitively. And part of that deals with sort of why we didn't win it the last time. We went through a lot of the things. And I think there's a couple of things that, you know, obviously the magnitude, the scope, we had the litigation, all that stuff. But there's a few things I want to address. Part of which is, do we do a really hard enough job to really cut through all the stuff that we need? And did we really define what were the money was going to use for. So for me, I'm going to support it and propose it, but I need the school committee to do two things. One is tonight, I think starting tonight and through Monday, you're going to go through your budget and try to find, to the best of your ability, with open eyes, open hearts, open minds, is there a way, are there things that could be moved around that can reduce the magnitude of the teacher cuts? I know that there's not a $1.4 million of things that you're just going to move. I understand that. Is there a little bit? Is there something? Are there assumptions that could be challenged? Are there line items that could be looked at? I know, you know, Dr. Daugherty, you said this is, and you worked hard on this, this is the best of a bad situation. I need you guys to just dig a little harder, work a little harder, show that, you know, yes, we've uncovered every stone, we've kicked under every rock, and that, you know, maybe there's a little bit of something that'll reduce some of the magnitude of those cuts. And I don't have any proposals. I'm not, you know, this is your budget and you have to do it. And really, you're the only ones who should be doing it. You know, well, you can go on social media and find all the budget experts, but it's really your budget, you need to do it. The second thing that I'm gonna ask you to do is that, assuming that we do get an override and it does pass, that you identify the things that you're going to put back in. Part of the criticism and even some of the letters that we got and the emails that we got were saying that I wasn't really sure what it was going to go for. And I think, you know, starting with these three gentlemen, clearly, you know, what's needed, but to really kind of prioritize and say, okay, if we get the money, this is how we're going to do it, and to really identify it. And obviously prioritizing the things like putting some of the teachers back, some of the things that are really the best things that will improve the classroom outcomes for students. And I think if we can identify and we can show the community that we've identified the need, it's clear, but that we've also gone out and we said, we've looked at everything. We've looked at absolutely everything, and you know, we challenged every assumption, and that if we get it, this is what we're gonna spend it on. I'm confident that the people of Reading are gonna listen, and they're gonna give us the money that we need to run the town and run the schools. So I'm prepared to be the first one to raise my hand at the selectmen to support that. But this is what I'm asking from you tonight, and not just tonight, but really going forward through your budget. You know, we're in the fourth quarter, but the game's not over. I think we can get this done. I think the town wants us to get it done. I think the town really wants to be able to support these. But as a selectman and hearing from people, not just, you know, the parents of school, but everybody, I think that's what it's gonna take to get it done. So I'm with you. What we've done, you know, together, I remember 2009 and 2010, when the economy and the world was falling apart, we worked together, the selectmen, the finance committee, the school department, the superintendent, the manager, you know, to really pull through. And I think we're gonna do it again. I'm confident we're gonna do it. We have to do it again. But in my estimation, in order to do that, we're gonna ask smaller, we're gonna identify what it is, and we're gonna show the community, we're gonna win that trust back, and we're gonna show them this is what we're gonna do, and we're gonna keep to it. Because and then when we come back, we can just say, how do we do? And if we need it again, I think it'll be easier. So with that, I will stop, let you guys sharpen your pencils and do your work. But again, you know, this is, I'm feeling more confident than I am despondent. And I know we can get this done. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
And have at it.
Thank you very much. There's only one little pushback I'm gonna give on that. I think you might be absolutely accurate that, and I agree with everything you said, so please don't. But I think that there may not have been awareness of what the override was gonna go to on the school side, but we absolutely published it, and we tried to communicate it. So at the time, there was a $1 million structural deficit. We said that first $1 million just keeps everything the way it is. Nobody, no cuts, no program changes. We just keep the trains running. And there was an additional $1 million, just under $1 million.
Yeah.
And we were literally a list. Two curriculum directors at the district level to coordinate curriculum in the humanities and STEM fields from pre-K through 12th grade. A middle school health educator for each of the middle schools, so with numbers next to it. So I just don't want anyone to feel like we didn't do that.
And
we
and
did.
And I apologize for sorry.
But
for
perhaps
that,
the
but
communication channels could certainly have been stronger.
I think the difference between October and January is that, you know, we're gonna keep things the same. But now there are things that have been identified as going away. And so, and I think that's what's brought out, you know,
yeah,
more people and more passion and more concern. And I think that's why it's important to identify the things that, you know, if we get more money, this is what we're gonna put back. And obviously, you know, how can you argue against the, you know, the foreign languages and the middle school stuff? They're taking the biggest hits. But I think that people are gonna wanna hold us to, say, okay, we're gonna do it, but they wanna hold us to, and where's it gonna go? And they'll hold us to it. Just so you know, and I forgot to mention this, I had the same conversation with the town manager, and I told him the same thing that I'm telling you now publicly, and I said, I need you to identify, you know, what are the things that if we get it, one, two, three, you know, and obviously on our side, it's a little bit easier. It's public safety, it's a few other things that have identified as one of the biggest needs. Here, there's so many, and I think people just wanna know that if I give you the money, you're gonna do it. And I think that's really important, and I think that's the biggest difference between that October and now. But I also think if, you know, people do not wanna see the devastation of the Reading Public Schools. They don't. Whether you have a kid in the school or not, whether you're a senior or somebody who just moved to town, you don't wanna see that. And I think we have to make the case, and that's how I think we have to do it, so.
Thank you. Mr. Robinson.
Yeah, I just wanna thank you for that. You know, I support what you're saying, and that we do need an override. You made the comment that we're in the fourth quarter. I think we're in the fourth quarter on our own 1 yard line, trying to get something done for April. I think we need to do something more definitive now. And, you know, we'll talk about that tonight. And I think that when we do that override, when we put our, you know, our talking pieces together properly, that could go to, you know, a solution, go to offset a solution I think we should talk about tonight.
No, I mean, you're right, we may be on the one level, but we've got time to.
Yeah.
We're going to get it.
And now I know you keep trying to leave, but now I have one more comment. Something I'm very proud of, although I was not happy with the outcome last fall, something I was very proud of was the level of collaboration between the town and the school side. Before any vote was taken by either board, there was this healthy amount of work between the town manager, the superintendent of schools, the board of selectmen, the school committee, a lot of public discussion, and a real, I certainly felt, speaking only for myself, that what we were putting out there was a community supported,
mm-hmm.
you know, it wasn't tilted one way or the other, it represented the same split. I just think that that approach, if we got anything right, we got that right.
Right.
So let's do that again.
No, absolutely, and we're going to continue to do that. And that's why, you know, other towns are floundering when they run into these problems. We don't. We figure it out.
Yeah.
So.
Thank you. Okay, Mrs. Webb?
I would just like to say that I think if there are Tom Brady's on our team, there are Dr. Darty and his administrative team and our town manager and our police chief and our fire chief. Those are the Tom Brady's. And frankly, I think we have been not the offense and defense they need. And so I totally appreciate what you said. I have the privy of having looked at Mr. Robinson's idea, what he's going to propose. It's going to be a good conversation. I just want to say, though, when in line with Mr. Robinson's idea about we may need to take some measure now and look at an override at a longer time, a slightly extended time period, we need to look at the lessons of the past. And when we passed the last override, we had every committee member on both boards, we had the police chief, the fire chief, the superintendent, everyone, the town accountant, the town treasurer, was on that videotape that Ken Tucci put together and was saying, we need to do this. And until all of our municipal leaders and our school leaders can be doing that together, an override won't pass. So we need to do all of what you said, Barry, but we need to do, I believe, all of what I was just describing, because that's the recipe that's been successful in the past.
Thank you. And I am going to call this, you announced quite a big thing. And we do have a budget that we need to get into. And it sounds like there will be further discussion about override in the future. So I just don't want the school committee now delving into opinions about.
No, and I didn't mean to.
No, no, no.
No,
public comment.
You
say what you want. So certainly, I just want to rein us back in on the budget. But did you have something, Dr. Doxer?
I do. I really appreciate you coming. Barry, and sticking your neck out and making a commitment. I know you're trying to.
That's all right.
Sorry.
I should have brought my phone.
He keeps trying to leave the room.
I
said you're never leaving.
And I appreciate the other selectmen that have come to our meetings as well. I just want to underscore, and I want to thank the gentleman for your presentation and reiterate what our chair said about we are listening. Our hearts are breaking at the same time as we go through this process. We are listening, and the decision in front of us, it's just an unbelievable decision that we have to make. But I am hopeful, like you expressed, that together we can work on it. But I think that in order to do that, we have to confront some things that aren't necessarily said, but they come through tone, and they come through questions. We need to get together in terms of appreciating and trusting the experts that have been doing the work along with us. And I underscore the along with us, because I know I've been meeting with the superintendent on my own since I started on the school committee. But that's been while I've been going through this budget as well. And I have been voicing questions and getting answers and watching how I was listened to through the whole process. And so we might be on the 1 yard line, but we got here because of the Herculean efforts of our experts, of our educators, and of the work that we've been trying to do together. And so I think that it's really important from the town standpoint and the school committee standpoint that we continue that working together and that we trust each other in our realms of expertise. So when we make whatever decision we have to make today, and I know you said look a little harder, look a little deeper, turn over every rock, we've been turning over rocks and we've been listening to very impassioned, wise people. And so when we get to that point where we have to vote and we make a decision, then that's the point when these rocks have been turned over and now we have to go forward. And the different boards have to collaborate and come together to move on what we've decided and to ameliorate it with an override. That's my opinion, like you said. But we need to trust the expertise of the people that have to make the decisions as well. And I think that we set an example for our kids and each other, not just from the words we speak, but the tone we use. And when the tone is undermining, but the words are positive, kids hear everything. Kids feel what's going on in school. I feel, and they feel it at home too. And I think that's our responsibility to model the education that our goal is. Our goal is not to educate kids just for career or for college. It's for life. And these kids are gonna go out there and fight these battles for the rest of their lives, because nothing's easy. Nothing's spoon-fed. The money isn't just put on our plates. And so I think that we need to work together and trust each other and open our filters so we can see other perspectives and where compromises come from. And I guess I'm being a little impassioned, but I feel like when we move on to our next steps, it's not just in words, it's in actions and in tone and in open filters, because we need to work together or this isn't gonna work. And our town and our kids and our families are gonna suffer. Thanks.
Thanks, Dr. Doxer.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Berman.
Thank you.
I'll ask at this point if there is any other public comment, either not on the budget, or if there is someone who really is under time constraint and needs to address the committee now.
I'm not under time constraint.
Then, yes. Thank you, Mrs. Downey.
Thank you, Mary Ann Downing, 13 Heather Drive. So this is just a complete confusion follow-up to a question I asked last night. Dr. Daugherty corrected something I asked last night about the science program implementation, and this is over the past couple of years, because I had in my mind that we had prior money to fiscal year 17, and back in the town meeting last spring, Article 5, we voted to add $150,000 first-year funding for new K-12 science curriculum, $150,000, and we voted to add that to the town operating budget for the fiscal year commencing July 1st, 2015. So as I understand that, that's the fiscal year 16 budget?
Yep.
That's $150,000 there.
Yep.
Then I looked at the fiscal year 17 budget, which is the current year, and there is $150,000 in that as well?
In the school budget.
In the school budget? It says in the introductory section.
I think we voted the budget. Gail saying it.
The money was in FY16. It wasn't FY17. The money was appropriated in FY16. We purchased all of the durable goods in FY16.
Right.
That's the only funding we've received.
So in FY17, in the introductory message, it says this budget is $150,000 over the guidance mandate.
Yeah. Mrs. Downing, we revoted the budget after time.
Mrs. Perry's here too from Finance Committee.
Oh,
right.
Okay.
I do remember that was a proposal in front of FinCom instead to put it in the present year's budget, and this way it got, you know,
Okay, so it did get shifted.
It did.
All right, so that was just the first part of my question.
Mrs. Downing, if I could just, because I'm not sure you were picked up on a mic. So we voted last year and said we would like $150,000 for the first year from FinCom, from free cash, and then went to town meeting, and there were funds that could have been, to not go to free cash, there was funds that could have been used, and the administration said, yeah, if we buy them now, we can use them next year.
Right, that's what I remember.
So that was the solution. And then we, as a school committee, revoted the budget after that at $150,000 lower. So that's why you're seeing an older version of the budget.
So it looks like, okay, I got it off the okay, I had
wonder if we didn't adjust and republish it.
That's why I was thinking we had already paid it. So my other question, though, in thinking, okay, we're using 150 in fiscal year 17 for three grades. So I'm just curious with this program, and this is the only time I'm going to touch into the future budget as we think about, okay, how much do we need for this? What is going to be the ongoing consumables cost for the Noah Adam program for five or six grades? Because 150, I know some of that is grade six this year. There isn't really a lot of materials. I keep my kids in grade six and he keeps bringing stuff from home. But there's only three elementary grades that we're getting for 150K that also includes some training. I don't know how much. There wasn't that much money in. Is the money going to the building budgets? Because I looked in the fiscal year 17 budget and it was only like 46,000 for science. And so where did the rest of the, how does the rest of the 150 this year go? And what is going to be our ongoing cost once we buy the curriculum for No Adam? Because I'm just, feels like a high consumable cost to me.
It is. Dr. Doherty.
I'll answer part one and we'll let Mr. Martin answer part
okay.
two.
Okay.
Sounds good.
So for FY18, it is in your building budgets for the consumables.
Just for the grades that we already.
Grades 4 or 5.
Right, yes. No new grades, I get that.
Correct. So that is in place, and the goal is to continue to.
So that's why the consumable, that's why science is up 104%.
Exactly.
Okay.
And I'll let Mr. Martin talk about future direction, if you'd like, with K-2.
Yeah.
And,
yeah, so.
Just quickly, because I know you have a lot to do.
Yeah, so grade six, we did begin a new materials, new program. It's not the No Adam program.
Right, it's iScience.
It's a different program. I mean, I just want to make sure we clarify that
right. This,
what we're doing in the elementary level, the cost associated really also has to do with the instructional approach of having consumables that need to be renewed, having the hands-on types of experiences and things, and really putting a focus on that. I don't have the numbers exactly. I think Gail was looking at we could get that at a future time. But we felt confident that in those three grades that could be sustained regardless of what happens in the future. We knew going in that we were going to be potentially facing tougher times, so we were already having discussions with not only grade six, but grade seven and eight, and we've begun some preliminary discussions with K-2. We assumed that we would probably not be able to extend the No Adam program, for instance, into the lower grades. We picked grades 3, 4, 5, and 6 to begin because we felt those were the higher leverage grades to make sure the kids had the firm foundation. Also, to be honest, that, you know, with our state assessment scores, there was some proven need in that area to get things changed and aligned much more quickly. And so we focused on those grades. We're still figuring out what we're doing for K-1-2. We don't anticipate a packaged sort of program.
Okay, so it's not like, okay, if you wanted those, that's another 50K, so now it's 100K consumable cost a year for this program. Okay,
right.
That was really what I was getting at once I got past the where the 150 went. Thank you. I knew there was an answer, but I remembered being at town meeting and voting enthusiastically for it. So thank you, that's all.
Thank you, Mrs. Downing. Any other public comment? Not on the budget. Yeah, Ms. Capobacci.
Hi, Erin Calvobacci, 494 Main Street. I actually want to talk about something that's positive. Last week, I did participate in the real-world problem solving at the high school, and I had chosen to co-chair, so I will chair it next year. And I cannot speak highly enough about this type of project for the school. This was the first year, from my understanding, and Dr. Dougherty, you could maybe correct me, this was the first year that it was parents who collaborated on the case studies. So with that, that brought more parental involvement and parents that are actually involved, working, and were able to bring what we consider to be more accurate problems for the students. And what this did for the students, because it focused on the areas that they would be most interested in studying in college, they had an opportunity to really put what they think they would be interested in studying further down the road to work. The big thing that I saw about it, though, is the judges that were also able to come in. These are the types of programs that our school system has to adopt because we had more collaboration from the community. We had someone from Amazon Robotics. What that says to me is this is someone that sees firsthand what is going on, and then we can go back to those businesses and ask for support. Support in dollars, support in more volunteerism from them, more collaboration. These are the types of outside-of-the-box thinking that we have to focus on, especially if we really want to prepare our students to the best of their abilities. It's what it was tremendous. I'm looking forward to next year, but I really cannot stress enough, more programs like this have to be instituted so we can have more buy-in from the communities and especially the community businesses. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming tonight and sharing that. I had lunch today. I went to an RCTV event, and I met a new woman from the community I never met before, and we spent about 20 minutes dissecting the dire fiscal situation that the schools are facing. And then she asked me about serving on the school committee, and I started talking about the things I've seen happening in our schools. And I found myself going, we've been talking about the budget so much that maybe it is very nice to talk about the amazing things I've seen in the classroom. And I think it just was very nice for you to come in and share that, because that is an amazing program and there's a lot of them going on. Thanks. Mrs. Rose.
I just want to add to that I know Mrs. Doxer and I have both been participated in that program because parents and community members have always been involved in the judging aspect of it. So this is a great addition, but I know we both had very positive experiences, and that the teachers who support those programs do a tremendous amount of collaboration, and many of them are teachers that have, you know, taken the Expanding the Boundaries class that Dr. Dougherty has taught over the years, and they apply many, you know, all of that sort of best in class, and it's been a pleasure to be part of that process in the past. So it's great that we continue to enhance it and have parents in even a more significant way.
Thank you. Any other public comment not on the FY18 budget?
Can I just say?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
But actually, I'm not sorry. I just wanted to add to that, that the problem solving, the everyday problem solving was once a pilot, and once a pilot that there were a lot of questions and issues around, whether it was when midterms would happen, which grade it would be, what the questions were going to be, who was going to work on it, what the follow-through would be. There have been lots of questions, and through the teachers working together, I know they spent time on it during the summer, as well as working with the administration, they have evolved this wonderful life-changing program. And so I just wanted to make the point that change is really hard, but that working together, we can make change work.
Any other public comment? Okay. Want to do consent agenda?
Is there anything anybody would like remove from the consent agenda? Okay. All those in favor of the consent agenda as presented?
6-0. Thank you. I do want to do reports. Alex, start with you.
The Drama Club is putting on a production of the 12 Dancing Princesses on February 3rd, 4th, and 5th, and they would really like your support.
That's great.
I think you actually have an envelope down there.
test one.
We do, from the parents supporting the student theater.
Any committee reports tonight? I have one. Today, I was invited to attend the first, I think it was the first, in what will be a series of many months long of work with RCTV. It was incredibly well attended. There were two selectmen there, at least, that I saw. It was an enormously, I can't even think of how much of a cross-section of the community it was. And what is precipitating it, just for the committee's information, is that Reading has a franchise license, a contract, if you will, with both Comcast and Verizon. They're 10-year contracts, and the one with Comcast is about to expire next year in 2018. So RCTV has reached out to a consultant to help the community manage the process. And then there'll be several focus groups and other events to learn about this and to have input. But there will be a lot of outreach to the community to ask what you're getting out of RCTV, our community access television, and what might be different in the future and what would be helpful. So I just encourage everyone to be thinking about that over the next few months. There will be an online survey coming this summer. That's an easy way for anyone in the community to give their input. It is a 10-year contract, typically. So it will be for a very long time. So it's worth the time now as a community to think through what we want. Mr. Bobbin.
I had a thank you from an author who spoke at an event I attended earlier this week. The Livewires put on an event at the Reading Public Library. The author was Tara Sullivan Boivin, and it's no coincidence that the last name is the same. That's my wife. And she wanted to thank the 62 Reading students who showed up for that event to raise awareness about a real-world problem that children in other places face. She wrote a book, and she talked about her book, and then the Livewires presented a documentary. Her book is a fiction book about two children in a real-world situation, written for middle-grade readers. So if you want to know more, please come find me afterwards. Thank you.
That's great.
We had the RICASA meeting this evening, and I know not everyone was there as we have this meeting, but I just wanted to, number one, publicly thank Erica McNamara, who made a great presentation at the Board of Selectmen, I think a week ago, and she's made excellent presentations to us. And we went over some data, and our school resource officer was there, Mike Malulo. The data on how we've been able to leverage the new service, the Williams
interface,
and be able to connect people who need mental health support, have anxiety, drug issues, and be able to connect them with providers. I believe like 80% of the connections were through the school. So it's a fabulous resource. A lot of local communities are part of that. And I also just wanted to emphasize that that on February 6th, is that next Monday? No, 2 weeks from now. So this is the Reading Coalition of Substance Abuse wanted to really highlight, and of course it's important to the schools, that there'll be a public hearing with the Board of Health on tobacco regulations and really starting to address issues with regard to vaping and the candy that's really nicotine behind the counters, and how that's Joe Camel all over again. So if what I just said doesn't sound familiar to you, then I would ask people to take a look at the RICASA website and also go on the municipal or the town website and take a look at what's going on with the Board of Health. And it's something that I think we need to be involved with. And in line with what Mrs. Doxer said about change, when our youth crew, the RICASA youth crew, put forward elimination of cigarettes being sold in the pharmacies in town, there was a significant pushback, and people were afraid this would damage our town, it would damage economic development, and we would be an outlier. And within a year, CVS rolled it out nationally, it was throughout the state, and it's been a model. So it may feel like we might be looking to make some changes that might feel uncomfortable again, but I really want to remind the community that when you look at how those changes are focused on our youth, the K kids who spoke today, all of the youth. What's the best thing for them? And you look at the gains, the data tells us, the gains that we've made in tobacco and alcohol usage, it's because we're doing the right things. So really, I know everybody doesn't have enough on their plates. They got one more thing. So you can go to like 3 meetings on that Monday night if you like.
Thanks, Mrs. Webb.
Thank you.
Any other committee reports? Administration?
I have no report.
I know we've seen you like every night this week.
I just have a quick reminder.
Oh, yeah.
The Special Ed Parent Advisory Council is meeting next Tuesday, the 31st at 7:15 in the superintendent's conference room. It is a business meeting, and all are welcome to attend.
That's great. I don't exactly know if this is, I'm torn on whether to do this during reports or budget, but I think I'm going to throw it out there during reports. In the last 24 hours, I've received one email and 2 phone calls. But they have not gone to the entire committee, and in all of the correspondence, I said I will report this out tonight for their information. They were all people advocating for certain components of the budget. All 3 wanted to stress the importance of the science curriculum and wanted to advocate for year 2 of implementation. One of them wanted to advocate for increased full-day K tuition to cover the cost of paraprofessionals to avoid that cut. One of them stated, if we go in the future, if we go down the direction of an override, her priority would be that we restore positions. So she wanted to articulate that. And she also said that she would love to see a resource officer for the middle schools. If we were ever as a community to be able to afford it, she felt that would be a very worthy investment. So I promised them I would, and now I have. Dr. Doherty, I believe to kick off our discussion, you have some slides to share.
Yes, and a lot of this is questions that have come up from committee members either at the last meeting or since the last meeting, and I will be brief because I know that we want to complete the conversation. I just want to start off again by saying that this has been, I said a little bit last night, this has certainly been a very long budget process. I mean, we really, if you think about it, been working on FY18 since June. We've just barely finished FY17. And there's an enormous amount of gratitude goes out to the committee. I know you've put an awful lot of work into this because I've seen it firsthand, so I appreciate it. We have had a lot of conversations about this budget, and the questions have been excellent, and they are public. Everything's on the website, so please, for the community, take a look at it. There's been a lot of thoughtful questions about this budget, and I appreciate that. I also want to thank my team, my central office team, and my administrative team. There's several principals here tonight and other administrators for their work on this. This has been a very mentally draining process since the override did not pass. And we have had a lot of conversations about what we felt was going to have the least impact on kids. And I know the cuts that have been presented don't seem that way, but we have reviewed and exhausted a lot of different options. And to speak to something that Mr. Berman said earlier, and to something I think that a community member said, you have my word as superintendent that if there's any funding that becomes available for whatever means, whether it be an override or a windfall of state aid or who knows what it is, that that we will work diligently, our administrative team will work diligently to focus on the classroom in putting the positions back that we that we unfortunately have had to reduce. So I want the community to know that, I want the school committee to know that our priority is the classroom and has always been the classroom in every budget that I've presented to the committee. Having said that, I want to go back in time just for a minute, and this was a slide, unedited, that we presented to you on September 26th, just prior to the override. And we talked about, this was at a time when we didn't think we were going to have, if there was no free cash was added to the budget, if no free cash was added, it was going to be about a $2 million reduction. And we did say at the time, if there was a $2 million cut to the budget, there would be 30 to 35 positions, FTE personnel. And then I went further, and I showed where those cuts probably would be and the impact of those cuts. So this was the September 26th slide. We talked about classroom teachers at the elementary, the support staff at the elementary, classroom teachers at the middle school, and classroom teachers at the high school, and we gave the impact. We didn't get into specifics, but it did talk about increasing class sizes, elimination of program, less support for teachers. All of these things were brought up at the time, prior to the override. And then we went into the scope also, there was also other reductions, and we talked about what possibly could happen in the non-personnel pieces. So this was something that unfortunately, has, you know, we're at a point now where that is come to fruition. It's a little bit less because there was $1 million of free cash that was infused into the budget. I do want to talk about a couple of other things that came up in the last conversation, just further to support the data. We had a lot of conversation about instructional leadership and how we are we don't have the instructional leadership that other school districts do. So this is a DESE category. There is a DESE category called curriculum directors, department heads, and school leadership. This is what would be classified as instructional leadership. According to DESE on the right is who would be in that category. And in some school districts they do exist, in some school districts they do not. And you can see where Reading lies, 26th in expenditure out of our 30 comparable communities. So this is an area that has been a concern. I showed you this slide a year ago when we were having conversations about the override and types of things that we felt we needed. But again, you know, again, it supports some of the things that we've been talking about. I also want to go one step further, and this is a conversation I started the last time about administrators in our school district and the amount of evaluation and supervision that they have. And you could see that, and I actually made an error. I was going off the top of my head, but the numbers were higher. The numbers are higher than I had said the other night in terms of staff per administrator. You can see that the elementary, because there's only one administrator in each building, they have a much higher evaluation load. Our middle schools are in 30s and 40s, 30s, and then our high school is at 37. So you can see across the board that the number of staff that our administrators are supervising and evaluating on top of the day-to-day operations of the school, and it's a pretty tight level. There were some other questions that came up the last time. The last increase for full-day kindergarten tuition was the 2010-11 school year. That was when it was increased to $4,200. And then I believe there was a question about the years that classes reached 26 or above at the elementary level. And there's a list of all of the times that that happened. In the 90s, it actually reached 29 a couple times. We did some research on it. So there were instances where class sizes were pretty high at the elementary. Most of it was before we had five elementary schools. You can see, I think there was only a couple of times that was the case after the fifth elementary school was built. So that, I know that was brought up last time. I also had a question there about the school calendar, and I did say something the last meeting about school calendar, and I just want to clarify. So you'll notice on the calendar that you approve every year that there are five snow days built in. Well, that's actually a requirement of Massachusetts general law in the student learning time regulations. So you see that purposely because the 5 days are supposed to be snow days. The theory being that we're never going to have more than five snow days, although that hasn't always been the case. It's been several years where that hasn't happened, and we've had to go beyond that. But we are required to schedule a school year that includes at least 185 days. And required to operate schools for at least 180 days. So that's under Massachusetts general law. This is separate than the discussion that's been happening with collective bargaining. So I just want to make that clear that this is totally different. We not only have a day requirement, we also have a time requirement, which is also here. Elementary have to go a minimum of 900 hours, and it's pretty specific what's considered instructional time versus what isn't. And middle and high school have to go 990. And then half-day kindergarten is a minimum of 425. So I just wanted to clarify that from last time, that this is under the DESE regulations,
that we have to abide by. And right now, the way we're going, we may be able to cut back on some of those days, right? Knock on wood.
That's always a recipe for a snowstorm.
It could snow during February vacation all at once.
All at once, yeah.
I also want to go back to a meeting we had on November 7th, guiding principles. I remember you gave me guidance on how to develop the budget, and then at the bottom, I know someone said this is going to be difficult. Good luck. So I wanted to make sure I captured that. But here are some of the things that you as a committee had expressed. Minimizing the impact on juniors and seniors. Focus should be on the core programs. Retain structures that will best promote social emotional. Maintaining frameworks and positions within our schools that support students. Maintaining programs, art, music, drama, course choices. No increases in fees and offsets. Unfortunately, that one didn't get accomplished. Budget needs to be sustainable, no gimmicks. And several of you said that. Preserve classroom teachers. Everything's on the table. Keep class sizes K to 3, especially low. Beware of state and federal mandates. And focus on academic achievement. So I'm not saying we were able to check them all off. But I just wanted to go back. This was the original guiding principles that you gave us at the November 7th meeting as we were starting to develop the budget. And then I did have a question about this, the salaries versus expenses. I did show this from last year during the summer, and I just, again, wanted to show you how our budget is broken down and how difficult it is just to cut expenses versus salaries. So you can see, thanks to Gail, she put all this together, this beautiful chart. The budget summary, you can see that the total budget, $41,301,661, that the total salaries makes up 83% of our budget. Only 17% of our budget is expenses. The town budget is much different. I believe the town manager told me last night it's 50-50 between expenses and salaries. So it really puts us in a difficult position. We are also, and this is a little bit different also with the town budget, represented versus non-represented is a much different ratio. So we have a lot more of the collective bargaining agreements that, that play a role in this. When you take a look at the expense piece, which is this bottom chart, that's $6,963,447, a lot of it's mandated. The particularly special education you see is $4,598,419. That's required by law. And then when you take a look at the other expenses by cost center, you see some of the things that make up the number. You know, you've got legal fees and audit and employee physicals. Those are things that are required. We have to do those things. Photocopier leases. There's some licensing we have to do. Regular day, you've got the building-based budgets, all of the supplies and materials, mandated transportation, technology. District-wide is health is really your medical supplies, extracurricular. That's transportation, athletics is transportation and rentals, and district-wide technologies, your servers and other infrastructure. And then in facilities, it's the contracted cleaning services and supplies. So you can see that there aren't a lot of expenses that we can cut without it having some sort of impact either legally or it's going to have an effect in another way. So it does put us in a difficult position as we're trying to cut $1.4 million from the budget. So I wanted to point that out. I know we've talked about it before, but I wanted to capture it so you know people could see the magnitude of what we were trying to accomplish with this budget that we were presenting to you. So,
can you go back to the previous slide?
Yes.
I think this is one of the most helpful slides we've seen. And if we saw it before, we saw it over the summer as we approached the override. But I agree with you. Ms. Dowd, it is a beautiful chart. It's very helpful to articulate the challenge that we're facing. Thank you for that, Dr. Doherty. That was helpful to frame the discussion. As we discussed at our last meeting, that helped? I don't know either. How's that? It's going to be really hard to hand it down the row. I'm happy to use it, but okay. Well, we'll see.
As we discussed at the last meeting, the approach that I'd like to take to keep the discussion focused and productive is to talk about potential cuts and then talk about, let's put in quotes, putbacks. So starting with this recommended budget, and I should make some remarks along the lines of what Dr. Doherty said. I think the staff's attention and work on this has been beyond. When the school committee submits 54 pages of questions and you answer them in 5 days, and answer them well and thoroughly and with footnotes so people can find the information. We're very grateful for the amount of work and thought that went into this, and not just to the people sitting at this table, but I know the principals were intimately involved in developing this budget, and I can't imagine how hard those conversations were. So thank you to everyone who was involved. I also want to say that we've done a lot of listening as a school committee. That's been our job for the last several months, listening to the administrators, listening to the teachers, listening to the parents, listening to the community. But I want to articulate that I don't believe there's anyone at this table who's happy about this situation. So we are going to deal with it because that's our job, and that's what we are elected to do. But that does not mean that we are not feeling a lot of the anger and frustration and despair that other people are feeling about the fiscal situation facing the Reading Public Schools. This is a moment, we'll dive into it, but I know it's been a very, very, very difficult couple of months for the employees of the Reading Public Schools. So to the extent that anybody listening to this has the opportunity to thank a teacher, to thank an administrator, to give a hug, to send the email saying, keep up the great work, you did this thing, it was amazing for my kid. I think this would be a really good moment for the community to come out and find any way that they can to support our teachers. They definitely need it right now. That being said, when I was looking through the budget, I found myself, I would categorize my approach as macro and micro. I started micro, and I quickly realized that I was finding $5,000 maybe here, maybe $15,000 here, maybe $40,000 here. Not sure it's a good idea, but we should discuss it. They were tiny, and they weren't even a drop in the bucket of $1.4 million. So then I stepped back and said, well, now I need to think macro. And then I understood why the administration came to the conclusion of restructuring things. You can't make cuts of this scope by looking at line items and taking 10% here and 8% here. You can't. You have to restructure. So with that, I guess I would like to ask, I'd like to split the discussion into the big ideas. Did anyone want to bring a big, completely alternate way of thinking before we get into the, I want to look at this line item for $8,000 and, you know what I'm saying?
I have just a question.
Yep.
Because I think some of the things that are reflected in some of the slides that are prepared of Mr. Robinson's were the things that I know that I also talked with the superintendent about. So are we going to go through those?
I would constitute that as a big,
okay.
A big thing. So yeah.
Okay, so I just.
Yeah, was going to, do you not want him to go?
No, I do. I just, is that what we're going to dive into first before we start the other things? We're going to go over the slides that are prepared.
Yes,
for
that's
okay.
What I was about
okay.
to do.
All right, I didn't know. I had no idea. I never saw these before, and you asked us all to provide input.
Yeah.
And we did, and then, I'm sorry, but when I only saw like Mr. Robinson's slides here, which I think are fabulous, I just didn't know what happened to the other input other than the ideas coming.
I'm glad that you said that, and
Mr. Robinson deserves all the credit.
I only just emailed it over and asked if I could have it as a talking point.
Okay,
We're prepared to address those.
Yeah. Mrs. Webb, you're right. I should probably, for people who weren't watching our last meeting, I had requested that anyone in the committee who wanted to make alternative proposals to email me and Dr. Doherty for two purposes. One is if people were requesting expense cuts, as he just showed, that were mandated, I really didn't want to waste committee time discussing that. I mean, if it's a mandate, we cannot cut it, so let's not have the discussion. So I wanted him to be able to kind of vet that and for myself to be aware of the discussion. The other thing, much more important, is if anyone on the committee wanted to discuss alternate personnel cuts. I certainly wanted Dr. Doherty to have the opportunity to reach out to the impacted personnel and have a conversation so that they did not first hear about that discussion on social media or on television or through the grapevine. That was just a matter of respect to our employees. So I heard from almost every member of the committee, Mrs. Webb, with various ideas. But Dr. Doherty knows them all and has been and is prepared. So,
okay.
Does that?
Yeah, I just, thank you.
Okay. But Mr. Robinson, I would characterize your, what you wanted to discuss as more holistic. So I do think it's a good place to start.
Yep.
So when I put this together, and I did a lot of reflection on 9 years on the FinCom before 8 years here, probably too long. I was 16 when I started, and you know, and some of the things we've done in the past, and obviously trying to remain respectful of, you know, the process that got us here, the meetings with the FinCom guidance, the discussions with the Board of Selectmen. And, you know, as I said, what I'm proposing are things we've done in the past. I think we're at that point right now, because I just can't see us trimming around the edges. I've drawn value judgments on my own value judgments on the things that I'm suggesting, but I won't go into those, because more importantly, to Ms. Borowski's point, you know, I heard the community loud and clear, and that I've talked to teachers and some administrators, and I'm hearing the things I'm hearing are the things that I think we need to focus on. It's not going to equal $1.4 million. But I think it's a good step forward, and as I get to the end of it, I'll talk about the override part a little bit, but since Mr. Berman brought it up, maybe I'll start there. I think it's certainly something we should do, but I am concerned that we won't do a good enough job if we try to jam that into April. What I would like to propose with this is, what if we go ahead with what I'm proposing, we then earmark some of an override that could happen in a year from now to go right into whatever was taken out of free cash. We've done that in the past. We did it in 2003 when I was on the FinCom. That was the last override. And we took $800,000 of that override and put it in a stabilization account. Different than free cash, because a stabilization account requires a two-thirds vote at town meeting, and free cash only requires a majority vote at town meeting. So we did that, and I don't believe to this day we've ever gone and taken any of that original $800,000, and that actual stabilization count has built itself up to, I think it's about $1 million. I was going off of the stuff that Sharon presented last night. I think we're up close to $1.6 million. So
stabilization.
Yes, I would. So I guess what what I'm proposing is a loan from free cash, and we go out there and get our act together and do the right job to get an override passed. And I'm not saying it's impossible for April, but I think, as I've heard a lot of people say, we have to do it right, because we can't go back a third time. And I think if we do this and we make that commitment, and to the FinCom, that, you know, it is a loan, and the override that we need to sell to the public says that we're going to repay that debt back to free cash. Again, it's not a new concept. It's something we've done in the past, think it's a good, it's a way to address what I heard loud and clear from, as I said earlier, the community, the students again tonight, and everybody. It's, you know, our reserves are at you know, healthy levels, and I've always taken a very judicious approach in using free cash accounts, and I think we're at that rainy day. So I don't know if you want to back up to. So the first thing I would propose we put back is the middle school classroom teachers. Again, the source of funding for that would be a free cash request. And by the way, again, I say loud and clear, I'm not trying to be disrespectful to the FinCom and their leadership. I fully appreciate everything they've done and the guidance they've given us. But as school committee members, you know, we've heard that, you know, our job is to advocate. So the next step is our job is to go sell this to the FinCom. And, you know, that's what we would do very respectfully. And again, I remind the committee that's something we've done in the past. I've sat at the table with Dr. Daugherty. I've sat there with your predecessor for certain. And, you know, if we have a solid argument, we can defend it. It's something that they're generally will listen to. And the, you know, as I point out up there, the rationale and Mr. Doxter went over the FinCom goal is to stay at 7%. By using this amount, we're still above that 7% guidance, which at 8%. So if you want to jump to the next one, then the next one is something that's been bothering me since the first time I saw this budget. We didn't hear a lot of it. I know Ms. Downing touched on it tonight. I went on record a year ago or 2 years ago and said that if we do this, we got to finish it. And right now, there's nothing in this budget that says we're finishing it. And that was a commitment that I felt like I was voting for on behalf of the community. So again, I think this is something that needs to be in the budget. Going back to the rationale, that additional $150,000 still keeps us above our 7% target. And then this is another thing that's been bothering me since the beginning. You know, obviously our special ed community is very vulnerable, so are our 5 and 6 year olds. And you know, the world we live in today isn't when I went to kindergarten, when you could have one teacher in there and it was, you know, a lot more babysitting than it is today. It's a very difficult, and a good kindergarten class needs help. Teacher needs help with when the kids go into their centers and all those sorts of things. You just can't do it alone. You can't be a lone ranger. And, you know, I think that we've heard, I've gone back and forth on whether we should raise a fee. I also broached the other night whether we should take more risk with our revolving accounts. I think I came to this conclusion in light of what I had on the previous two slides. I said, you know, we are taking some risk there. Maybe here we gotta pay our own way on this one. And so I can't remember exactly. I think it was $25 increase or what? Okay, I'm
so
sorry.
It would go to $44.50.
Right. What did I say? I left the zero off. So, and we heard from a lot of parents that they were amenable to that. I think we also could make available scholarships if necessary. So, you know, I think, again, in this society, we can't, we cannot do some, and that, that 50,000 is a little bit of money that causes a lot of problem as far as I'm concerned. And then the other thing that was, Dr. Daugherty mentioned the good news the other night, and I jumped up, well, you know, we can't, but I've had time now, you know, and I like to, I don't like to make decisions the minute I hear, so I had time now to think about it, and it is the right thing to do, to not try to redeploy that 130,000.
It's 105. 105. That was my fault that I said
110. Try to redeploy that somewhere else. It should, it should go back to the elementary teachers. And yeah, and as I said, it's no trying not trying to be very respectful. And again, I will be the first one to help because this is a loan as far as I'm concerned. And but I think that, you know, I'd rather, you know, as I said to Mr. Berman, I don't want to be on our, my own 1 yard line. I want to be on the Falcons 1 yard line. And I think if we have 12 months to mobilize, I think we have a better shot at the override. So, thank you. Yes.
Oh.
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Robinson.
So, obviously, when this was the, our first opportunity to see Mr. Robinson's suggestions. So I just, I want to make a comment, because I've been reviewing to remind myself of what our budget policies are. That we hold ourselves accountable to. So I think one of the important things that Mr. Robinson is enabling us to do is that under our budget planning process, the major portion of income for the operation of the public schools is derived from local property taxes. We are all well aware of that. We are taxpayers, we have heard from taxpayers for months about the impact of taxes, increases in taxes for our municipal and school services. However, the first priority, oh sorry, the school committee will attempt to protect the valid interest of the taxpayers. And again, I think Mr. Robinson highlighted that. However, the first priority in the development of an annual budget will be the educational welfare of the children in our schools. And I think that, you know, we are required to provide a budget that achieves those objectives. And we had said from the get-go that we're not achieving the objectives, we're taking it apart. So I think it's, I think the other piece of why, again, I would certainly want to be respectful of FinCom, absolutely. And I appreciate that Mr. Robinson sort of went through all the history and used his experience on the financial committee prior to being on the school committee. The history of the, of our community passing the overrides basic says that a April override is extremely risky because of the short amount of time that we have. And I think that it's so important. It's been one of my major concerns that we need to do this correctly and we need to do it so that it serves the needs of the schools and the municipal services. And you know, given our immediate experience this fall, given our past experience 14 years ago, I think that I approach this, this generally, this approach is one that's really resonating with me if it's something that we can, you know, gain acceptance from through the financial committee.
Can, one other, before, I'm sorry, yep, one yep. other comment I just wanted to really emphasize the second to last bullet that kind of goes with the loan. I mean, I'm adamant that, you know, anything that proves positive in what we do, and I'll leave it at that, will immediately, I will this, I mean, we have to, it has to be the committee, but my opinion is it should immediately be used to repay that debt.
Dr. Nine?
Yeah, I'd just like to commend Chuck for the work he did, and we've had lots of discussions back and forth. And he's the only person, I think, on the committee that really has the credibility to bring forward such a strategy. And I think that it meets all of our needs. And I know I have a list of things that I would recommend that we would have to delve into, none of which are good, none of which is, as Dr. Daugherty has stated clearly, none of his are either. I think this is a absolute great suggestion. And I do agree with Elaine that we probably need to do a fall override so that we don't have to put the staff and everybody back through all this. I've been around when we did spring overrides, and they're not very comfortable. Again, affects teacher morale, affects effectiveness, teacher effectiveness. And anyways, that said, I think it's an absolute great idea, Chuck, and I appreciate you bringing it forward.
Yeah, it's all right.
They
okay, no, I'm sorry. Anybody else on the committee? Yeah, it'd probably be good if.
Yeah, that makes an action you work on. Just pull it up.
About it. Oh, this feels very awkward.
Sorry.
Anybody else on the committee want to make a comment on this kind of global approach? Mr. Bobbin?
Chuck, I just had a follow-up question on repayment of the loan in the event that the override didn't pass in 12 months. How would you envision, would we negotiate, propose terms of repayment over a fixed period of time, or how would you approach that?
The override's going to pass, but... I haven't, we'd have to figure something out in terms of, you know, whether we use less down the road. You know, the real, you know, and other expense discussions, you know, leave it at that. I don't know what those are at the moment.
Thank you.
I have a question about this too. Am I correct then that this would truly be a one-year stopgap measure? Because I think asking the question, if an override passes, this works. If an override doesn't pass, are you working under the assumption then that we move forward with the significant cuts that we're looking at this year? Maybe not these exact cuts, but if you wouldn't anticipate, in the event that an override didn't pass, going back to FinCom again and saying, you know, can we do this again?
Yeah, we would need to decide whether and this may help with some of your question, whether it stays in the base, because if it's free cash, it will go in the base, which gets
split.
Goes up by whatever the budget does.
Mm.
So the question, we would have to decide whether it stays in the base or it comes out of the base and we start back from scratch again.
Just clarify, so what that would mean that whatever if the override fails, then that if an override were to happen and it failed, we would be in a position of cutting the budget and sort of also taking that value of free cash to put back to free cash potentially. So it would mean that it's really a one-year loan and the cuts would be more dramatic than they are today for sure.
Ms. Robinson, thank you for putting this down on paper. I'm fully in support of the kindergarten approach, and I can pray that the town will be responsive to the loan idea. I think that's a great, very creative idea. My concern is I also have worked on many overrides, both here and in Wakefield. And one of the mantras that comes out is, well, you found the money before, you'll find it again. And my concern is, right now, people really know, I think, what we've been going through to try to minimize the damage, minimize dismantling our school system because of the money that we don't have. And if we find this money, and that's just going to be the perception, the general perception, because people already perceive free cash as free cash. So if we put this off till the fall, we find the money, people don't feel the cuts. I'm really afraid that people are going to say, well, you did it that time, you can do it again. So I'm sort of feeling like we have motivated people, we have a structure that was just used in the fall. I'm afraid to put this override off. I think we need it. And I think with the promise that we'd be putting back the money that we're using to not dismantle our system, I think that there will be more people on board from across the generations and across the town, with kids in school, without kids in school. So,
Yes, go ahead.
So one of the, in all the discussions about in the debriefing and about why the override didn't pass, and one thing I haven't heard anybody say, and I'm sure it may have been part of it, was, and anybody that's been paying attention and looking at this town's reserves would vote no on an override because we have free cash to use. That's what it's there for, for when you have tough. I mean, the last time when we did the override, and Bob's not here, but he could probably verify. When we did the override in 2003, our free cash was, I think, less than $500,000. Reserves, not free cash, everything. Less than $500,000. Very different scenario when this override went on the ballot and that was always in the back of my mind. I don't know whether, but that's why people voted no. But anyone that was paying attention, that could have been one of their reasons.
Sorry. I just want to say one quick comment that Ms. Doxer referenced sort of a group or a system that's in place. That if you were referring to the ballot question group, that was a political ballot question group, and they disbanded because they were specifically formed for the ballot question. So, I don't think we should speak for those community resources. I have a question though about this process, because I was actually hoping we'd get through this discussion and vote on the budget tonight, and this basically is a question that we can't answer tonight because we don't know the mind of FinCom or the vote. This would probably require a vote of FinCom. So and FinCom is not gonna meet between now and Monday. So I'm not sure how we answer that.
I can respond to that.
Okay.
So again, historically what we've done is given a FinCom, or given the town manager a budget that was out of balance with what the guidance was,
mm-hmm.
And his job as the town manager will probably be to take that out, and then it will be our job to go to the FinCom and defend putting it back in.
Can I Dr. Nye's been waiting and really, really, really waiting.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks. Question, Chuck. The stabilization fund, that's part of the current free cash, though, right?
Well, it's a separate, there's a free cash account and there's a stabilization, it's part of our certified reserves, really. Yeah.
So, I guess I'm still a little confused. So, is it, when we count the free cash, whatever we said it was, was it 8?
630.
All right, 638.
When they use that guidance number, it's not 7% free. It's not 7% free cash. 7%. It's reserves. 7%. Reserves are made up of free cash, stabilization fund.
So it's a separate account.
Sale of real estate fund. Revolving funds, FinCom reserve fund.
So it's a separate account. So when they give us the amount for free cash, the stabilization fund is not in there.
No, it's in the, I have that.
It's part of the free cash calculation.
Okay, that's what I was asking.
Well, I, the reserve calculation.
Yeah, the reserve calculation.
Oh, now I confused it again.
If you just ask for free cash, though, you're not getting the whole picture. I think that's what you're trying to understand, right? If somebody's just telling you this is what we have in free cash, that's not all of the reserves.
Okay.
Yes.
But it, it's.
Anybody want to change their mind on that again?
It's liquid, but except to the extent it requires a two-thirds vote at town meeting to get to, as opposed to free cash, which just requires a majority vote.
Okay, I get it now. The other thing I want to say, I really support Chuck's strategy of, you know, a longer delay for the override for the reason that was actually brought up last night. I don't think, you know, we've all guessed as to why the override didn't pass. But I think we need to do more research to find out. I mean, I've talked to numerous people about it, and I don't necessarily hear a consistent response that why it didn't pass. I think, you know, somehow or other, you know, a questionnaire, a poll, or something that we can get. Gene and I talked about this after it failed. That we've got to find out why it didn't pass. We just can't, like, go back out there and do the same thing over again and expect it to work. So that'll give us time to do that. And I certainly understand Dr. Dox's point of view that it is, you know, pressing, but I also think that this proposal gives us, you know, breathing room to kind of rethink, you know, how we go about the override. And then ultimately, it's, you know, it's back to the Board of Selectmen anyways, too. We just want them to know eventually,
right.
We'd vote on whether or not we agree on it, so. But anyways, that was my comment.
Just to maybe focus the discussion a little bit, I know that there is really no way to tease out this proposal and discussion of a potential override, but I just want to focus on, the focus tonight is passing the FY18 budget.
Mm-hmm.
So try to keep that I think tactics about when to have another override and how it will look is more under the Board of Selectmen's purview, and also, to the extent that it's related to this budget, we have to discuss it, but to the extent that it's not, let's focus on the budget. Are you sure?
Unless we can come back to
okay.
That. So I really want to highlight our policy again because I think it's so important. And one of the things that it says, because of resource limitations, there's sometimes a temptation to operate so that fiscal concerns overshadow the educational programming. Recognizing this, it's essential that the school system take specific action to make sure education remains central and that fiscal matters are ancillary to contribute to the educational program, and this concept will be incorporated into the committee operations and all aspects of the school system's management and operations. And I'm just citing that because, again, it's part of our 3 or 4 budget policy, budget policies in our policy book, because it really speaks to this struggle and that we're to take this apart we are not doing our duty as a school committee to do really this level of damage to the educational programming. And so now that I fully understand how we would do this process, so Mr. Robinson's proposal here then really is to add the $588,000 to the budget that we would potentially vote. And then we would be bringing that to the town manager. So I just want to make sure that I understand.
Yeah.
Okay. And it specifically addresses the, I just want to review, specifically addresses the 7 middle school classroom teachers at $438,000. The kindergarten paraeducators would be restored, but through the $250 increase in the fee. Okay.
Yeah, that's a net. No
right.
One.
And then the $150,000 for the science curriculum to continue that, and then That's how we get the total of the 588, is the 438 and the 150.
Right.
Okay, I just wanted to be sure that I was really clear on that.
Just to add to that, the other thing you said in your proposal I feel really strongly about is the two elementary school teachers staying there to lower the class size or keep the class sizes from going up. And that, as we heard from Mrs. McGinnity, is essential to them using the science program in the best way, because if the class sizes go up, only one teacher just can't do everything. And so in terms of priority, I put the elementary school teachers ahead of the science curriculum. I think that would be wonderful to have it. But if I had to make a choice, and I guess I am making a choice, I hope that the finance committee will approve that extra money, but it's more important to me to have those teachers empowered in the classroom with not larger sizes.
My point on the two middle school teachers was that elementary school teachers, that's no longer on the, it was taken off of Dr. Daugherty's reduction list, and when he did that, we could have said, well, leave those cuts there. I want you to redeploy that money to something else. What I'm saying is leave it where it was. I agreed with him. So it's really, that's more a statement in this proposal than it's not impacting. The only real impact is the $588.
I just wanted to reaffirm what you were saying, that that's really a priority for me. And it is a choice that we have when we're unpackaging everything. So I would like the two teachers to stay.
I want to thank Chuck for his creative thinking and very much out of the box approach to this. I want to point out a couple things that haven't been sent yet. So the amount of money we're talking about here would be $638,000. It's about 1.6% of 40 million. 438 plus 200?
That's 588.
That's a fee.
That's the
150.
I'm sorry, so it's 588. I would look at two things very closely. One is the fact that we're asking for someone else's money for this, right? So this is not school committee money. And I would look at, it's not our decision to make, as everybody has already stated. What is the purpose of the funds that we're going to be borrowing? And what is the nature of the use of those funds? So just make sure we're clear on those two things and the choices that we'd be making. To me, the first item on Chuck's proposal, the middle school classroom teacher restructuring the 7 FTE, represents the undoing of a pretty, in my mind, significant and potentially permanent at least for the students who would go to school that year, restructuring of their day. They would lose a class period. They would lose access in the seventh grade to foreign language. This is a definite and permanent harm in my mind, and I think we should avoid it. And I think it would be difficult, as Jean pointed out earlier, to find other pieces of this budget that we can cut without destabilizing what is left of our school system to achieve a $438,000 reduction. I wasn't able to do it when I went through this with hammer and tongs, and I would suggest and get behind this idea of asking for a loan for $438,000 would be something I would support because of the nature of the cut. I would want to look very carefully if our cost structure continues to rise at 3% per year, which is what we've seen, 3 to 5% increases, at how we would repay this loan in event we didn't have an override. Because I think that's a reasonable question to ask of someone that is paying the taxes or of someone who's loaning you the money in either case. So I want to make sure we're aligned on that. These other two cuts, while mitigating them would be very valuable, I would like to hear the other ideas of the committee, the $150K, and the $50,000, not because the objectives are not extremely important, but because I'm curious whether the committee was able to find other approaches to removing these detrimental harms to our students? So are there other places we could find 150K? Are there other places we could find 50K for the kindergarten groups? So thank you.
Thank you.
I guess to, not to throw a wrench into all this, but I'm just wondering too, what happens if this isn't approved by FinCom? Where do we go then? Do we go back to the drawing board and say, we're gonna just maintain the cuts that we're talking about now, or do we have another discussion bringing out some different ideas that some of us have come up with? I mean, personally, I'm hopeful that this FinCom will approve it, and it's a very sound approach, so, but I do think we need to be prepared, you know, what's gonna happen, what are we gonna do if in fact, you know, it doesn't fly?
We could, I think either or both, that would be up to the chair to decide how she wanted us to proceed, but we could either revert back to where we are, or we can reconvene. That's really up to the chair to decide how to move on with that.
And on that question, I would certainly take input from the committee on how to approach that. I think it's a good question. Mr. Boivin said something that I have been thinking. I don't want to muddy the waters too much, but I approach the budget, I think, similarly to how you did. I've read it 3 times straight through. You should look at the amount of notes and highlighting and questions. I couldn't come close to $400,000. I couldn't come close to $100,000. Not without, destabilizing is an excellent word, not without destabilizing the system in a way that would cause a whole other different kind of harm. And I think I agree with that. So part of, to answer that question is, if we wanted to come back, I think we would have to some assurance that someone on the committee, this comes back to the thought, do we have a better approach? Do we have a better way to cut $400,000? I think I'm hearing consensus around the thought that this is an unacceptable cut. And in thinking that through, the reason I'm so glad you attacked the middle school problem, those cuts, if we were to make those and then an override passes, how do you fix that? You've let go of a tremendous amount of staff, you've restructured a program, you've cut a program, and you have to rebuild it from scratch. That's just poor management is what that is. So I think that's part of why the community reaction to this particular area was so strong, and why I think I'm hearing some consensus, and I certainly feel any solution to the middle school one, we need to look at really, really carefully. Anything else from the committee on this? Yeah.
To Gary's point about next steps, since we can't convene FinCom right now to take a vote, my suggestion for consideration is that we go through the budget and see what other ideas are out there.
Yep.
And we could arrive at a position where we have a proposal. We could vote, for instance, an unbalanced budget by a certain amount.
Mm-hmm.
That would automatically force this issue with FinCom. We could also vote some kind of I don't know how it would work out. Maybe we'd have a series of cuts and we'd say, well, if this, then not that. But I think we need to finish going through all the ideas that we have, voting on those, and see what we have at the end of that process.
So I think you're right, Mr. Boivin. And now the best laid plans that I had, we're gonna have a little bit more of a free-flowing discussion now. I think this is a good time to talk about alternatives. And I'd like to share with the committee, as I said, I took a macro and a micro approach. The micro approach yielded nothing, and I think I've explained why. The macro approach, I actually wanted to address 4 areas that I thought about, speaking only for myself, that I heard from the community, a real desire that the school committee look at. So, and then these are on the larger scale, so I want to address each one. One was athletics. I certainly heard from many people that as important as sports are, you're talking about cutting core academic courses, isn't there a way that you can cut sports? Ms. Dowd, I hate to put you on the spot, but I think the entire athletic budget is about just shy of 600,000, like 580, somewhere in there, right? And about half of that is fee subsidized. So if I'm reading that right, and if I'm understanding that right, you know, I apologize, I do have this marked. For anybody who, anybody's interested, it is page 64. So the complete athletics budget for the town is $562,000. And I believe the offset's close to 400.
The next year is 375.
375, yeah. So what I'm saying is, this is illustrative, it's not a suggestion at all, but I'm articulating my thinking on this as people ask the question. So if you were to cut, and I'm, again, not at all advocating for this, but hypothetically, you cut the entire sports program of the entire district, no more sports at all, you would save about $200,000.
And we'd have to have a bigger meeting room.
But my point is, I think there's this perception that there's a lot of money there that we can save, and there just really isn't. Nothing that comes close to $1.4 million. And I will, so the athletics thing I wanted to address. And I will share that a lot of you know that in a previous life, I was a public high school English teacher, and I have vivid memories of a lot of students, but one in particular, who graduated high school and stayed passing his courses because he was a high school athlete. For a variety of reasons, school was not his priority, school was not his family's priority, but by God, when it was football season, it was baseball season, he kept his grades passing. The most delightful kid, the most respectful, just a wonderful kid, just school was not his priority, and nothing I did as a teacher was going to change that, but his coaches made sure he was passing English when it was in season. Also, school was sports were by far his favorite part of the day and what kept him coming to school. So just to make the priority, I certainly value athletics, but I think the perception that that's an area where we can yield great savings is just numbers-wise, it's not true. And so I wanted to communicate to the public, I certainly thought about that suggestion and I looked at the numbers. Another area that we certainly heard a lot about was administration. So I wanted to talk about my thinking on that. I think this is on page 50. The entire administration budget, Dr. Doherty? It's just over $900,000, somewhere in that. So again, the idea that we should cut administrators, you should cut the administration, even if we cut the entire administration and had a school run without any leadership. Which would be illegal, because many of these positions are mandated by state law. But even if we could, actually wouldn't solve the problem. It does not solve the problem. So never mind picking at the edges doesn't solve the problem. So I looked there. But then I wasn't even further satisfied, and I asked Dr. Doherty, and he presented it, I think, at our last meeting, to please go through every single FTE with a job description. He articulated to us what every secretary does, what every administrator does, what every principal does, what every assistant principal does. I did not see anything there that would, I keep coming back to destabilizing, many of those positions to me come down to student safety. You cannot have a building, especially at the high school of this size with this many kids in it, without enough adults to manage that. So I looked at it very, very, very closely. I do not see a cut there, beyond the one that Dr. Doherty proposed, which is in the budget area and the finance area. I don't see another one. I wanted to. I was looking for one. I don't see it. The two other areas I looked at were professional development, and I think this one is very complicated because of reporting to DESE. There's been a lot of confusion about it. I think Dr. Doherty did a good job. I suspect we are going to have to continue to find ways to communicate this more clearly, especially at town meeting. There's a lot of belief that there's a lot of money there, but the discretionary amount is about $50,000. I thought long and hard about it. I would be open to a discussion about it. $50,000. You zero it out, it's not even one teaching position. And you zero it out, and then you say, we know we have teachers who need support in improving academic achievement and no way to help them. So I'm open to a discussion on it, but at the end of the day, we would be saving a tiny bit of money that doesn't even begin to address the problem. The final thing I looked at, which is very sensitive, but in full transparency, I want people to know I thought about it, was art and music. Because I heard it. People said, "What have you looked at this?" I'll let Dr. Doherty correct me if I get any facts wrong, but in thinking it through, we can't cut it at the elementary level because the teachers need contractual planning time, and they get it while the children are at their specials. So you can cut art and music at the elementary level, then you need to hire people to watch the children. It would make no financial sense. There's no practical way to do it. I don't think anyone would advocate for cutting it at the high school level, especially with our award-winning art and music programs. So the only option is at the middle school level. So we would have a district where you have art and music education to fifth grade, and then 3 years off, and then start up again in ninth, which is practically doesn't make logical or organizational sense. It also would have a devastating effect on the quality of the arts programs at the high school, which, as I said, are award-winning. We have award-winning bands and choruses. When people ask, like, well, didn't they consider alternatives? Those are four I considered. And I can't defend any of them. I don't think they're the right solution. I have to say, for my money, Mr. Robinson gets the MVP award tonight because he solved the problem I was desperately trying to and I couldn't, which is the $400,000 middle school problem. So I'm sharing that with the committee, not because I have a solution, because I don't. I don't have a solution, but I certainly don't want anyone on the committee or anyone in the public to think it wasn't for a tremendous effort.
Thank you, Ms. Borowski. I just want to emphasize on the administration. I think also we heard, what's tonight, Monday night, I believe Principal Heather Leonard was here from Barrows, and we were talking about the assistant principal positions at the, or stipends, at stipend positions. I think I came to the conclusion that after that discussion and then having a little bit more discussion, that really was, that's like a teacher leader. It's a person who's in the building who can be called on really in an emergency. It's not, I don't really think it is a sort of a succession planning. It highlighted for me that, you know, that is an area that we've been talking about that we are, you know, deficient as a district. It just highlighted for me how hard that job is. Those principals have 50 direct reports that they're supposed to supervise and manage. The way that teachers become better is by getting coaching and mentoring and getting evaluated, and we're not addressing that. So I appreciate you taking another look at that. I also just want to say that I looked hard at the foreign language. Obviously, we heard a lot about this from middle school, and I was really struggling with this because, I didn't know exactly where we were going to go with the cuts, and I really tried to look at the data. I understand everything that people were saying about how important language is, but when I looked at the data, and Dr. Doherty provided it, there was on average 120 students a year that take all four levels of a language in high school. So those are the students that then in their fourth year, they're taking a level 5 SEP or honors, or they're taking AP of the language. And we've been talking about how we're going to impact that progression. The proposal, so should this loan not get approved and we have to go back to the cut of this program, I just want to say that the proposal, which was at least for next year, with the current seventh graders who are have the language right now, they would go into eighth grade, we would be able to serve 2/3 of those students, which is 57% more than the average of the last 2 years of students who have progressed to the fifth year. So I was trying really hard to try to understand this. So I think, you know, if we had to make that cut, we could only do it for just this 1 year without impacting other students, because then you have sixth graders that aren't getting the extra ELA block, which is part of restoring the language. And you have the seventh graders that aren't getting the language. So I think, while you could argue, it might be lesser of than some other impacts that we have, it's very painful. So I'm hoping that we don't have to come to that discussion, but that's, you know, one of my thought processes. And I think that the foreign language, you know, what you do in that second year, if we have to make this cut, what you do in the second year is then even a bigger decision.
Yeah.
So I want to add just one more quick thing, because I was, sorry, I could put my glasses on. I'm looking at page 34. And the, perhaps we can dialogue with FinCom that, you know, we can make good on this loan, because we returned $593,000 in FY14 and $250,000 in FY15 and $118,000 in FY16. So we're pretty good, and we have a very long history of returning free cash. So if the override were to pass, we would, I believe we could make good on it. But I'm, so I just sort of wanted to highlight that.
That's a really good point.
Lane, that is a great point.
Here we go.
So we have in the past historically budgeted based on a set of assumptions, and things like out of district PD, special education costs, for example, we have to budget for in a way that we make sure that we meet our obligations. Often it's my understanding, you know, Carolyn, Dr. Daugherty, from our conversations, that we don't end up spending as much, and historically we haven't for some of those estimates, because we have to be safe and conservative in those estimates. So we're being just as safe and conservative in those estimates in this budget as we always have been. We have a rather consistent enrollment history in this district, and we have the ability, I think, to predict enrollments and student need now to a greater degree than we did when we started this process. So my thought here is that a basis to return these, to pay this loan, is based in part on our historical ability to harvest additional funds at the end of our budget year. That the, and if you look at the 438K up to 588K range of this proposal, that's consistent with the ranges we've seen, or close to them, in the past. So I think that's important information. On the flip side, I want to just make sure we understand that this loan is on the order of 1.25% to 1.5% of our $40 million operating expenses. And if those operating expenses grow at 3% next year, hypothetically, then you'd be tacking on, if we were to have to repay this loan in the absence of additional revenue, an additional 1.5%. But hypothetically, if we had higher cost, this would add to our costs in the future. So I want to make sure we're aware of that and have a contingency plan and a basis to pay the loan back. I really like Elaine's thought on that point.
Just curious, Jean, do you recommend that we make suggestions right now?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If you'd like to bring up alternatives, this is a good time.
All right. I'll do that. I want to clarify that, as Dr. Daugherty has explained, difficult decisions. I've already mentioned most of them to him and his administrative team. So I'm not looking for rationale why we shouldn't do it.
Yep.
I'm just going to make a recommendation that it's feasible to do it. Not a good idea, but, you know, with the circumstances we're faced with, maybe it's better than what we currently have. That would be up to the committee to determine. One that's a difficult choice would be literacy coach. That's $78,000. My rationale for that is, even though I've heard great things about what our literacy coach has done, you know, I looked at our PARC MCAS results, and I see no real appreciable difference between the math and the literacy or the ELA results. So I'm not really sure why that takes preference over the math, I guess. I find it difficult to justify one over the other. The other part of the reading one is, the ELA or the literacy one is that we have reading specialists in each building who are fully trained in the teaching of reading and literacy. Now I know the purpose of the literacy coach is to actually coach, and that's definitely beneficial, but I see the same thing. I'm almost tempted to say we should put the math coach back, which doesn't help the situation though. Another one is a reduction in the administration cost center. And again, I've talked at length with Dr. Daugherty, administrative staff, understanding, you know, I've been in another district, I've seen what I work closely with other districts, I know the type of administrative teams that other districts have. Excuse me, there's no question ours is lean, but I also look at it as, you know, it's 10% of their budget, and, you know, maybe it could be made up some other way. I'm not saying any particular position, but I can say that this one might scare a few people, but I know there's a retirement at the middle school.
Let's not talk about specific staff members.
Oh, okay, well, I was just gonna say that maybe this is a creative way to fold positions together.
Okay.
Anyways, and then another two ideas. One is a reduction of the building budget by approximately 15%, and I'll make this statement from my own personal experience that it's pretty standard that building principals hold back at least this much or close to this much till the end of the year. And as I recall, the rationale behind it would be in the event that they do not have a full building budget the following year, they can use these funds at the end of the school year to purchase materials for the next fiscal year. And so I guess my statement would be this: the time has come. Again, I fully understand why they do it. I did it myself. I did it as an administrator. I did it as a teacher. But that's just a recommendation. That's just a thought. Another one would be, and this one's risky, but and I don't think I did mention this because I just came up with it, but would be to use available funds due to staff turnover, and then also the amount of budget that's returned at the end of the fiscal year. So I would recommend $150,000 be adjusted or recommended to anticipate that be available at the beginning of the school year, as again, due to staff turnover, and also the amount returned to free cash at the end of fiscal year 2018. I can just give you a quick history. 2015-16, there was $385,295 available due to staff turnover. This current year, there was $243,541 available due to staff turnover. And then fiscal year 2015, we returned approximately $250,000 to the town. In this past year, we returned $118,808 to the town. So 150, I think, is kind of conservative. For that total, it's $405,450. Do I think that these are good ideas? I think they're all, you know, these last two that I mentioned are risky, but certainly don't feel as though it's a great idea to eliminate any of the coaches, because as Dr. Daugherty knows, you know, in terms of administration, and I've been a strong supporter of the coaches, and it was excited to see that we were putting them in place. I've seen them benefit teachers greatly, and heard from other colleagues who are teaching in other districts that have the numerous literacy coaches or math coaches available. Each building had a coach. So anyways, those are different districts than ours, for sure. So those are some ideas, not necessarily good ideas, but that's what I thought of.
Can I just ask a clarifying question, Dr. Nyhan? Are you proposing those, are you advocating for those, or more bringing them up for discussion?
Good question. I don't really want to discuss them so much. I just want to throw them out there. I'm hopeful under the circumstances with Chuck's proposal. I think it's premature to do that. I'd rather go through the process that Chuck brought up to see how that works.
Okay.
You know, these are something that, you know, if we go back to it, maybe we talk about them then.
Can I just clarify?
You can, but I'm just going to thank you for that clarification. So it sounds to me like you were doing what I did, which was, you know, sharing, this was my best attempt.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it's necessarily, as you said, these are not good ideas, but this is what I was thinking. But it also sounds like you perhaps might think Mr. Robinson's is a more palatable approach.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you for that clarification. I just
had a clarification. So when you refer to staff turnover, are you talking about someone retiring and a younger person coming in, or so the salary's lower? Is that
in discussion with Gail and Dr. Daugherty, request that information. That, I guess that's what it would most likely be, I would assume. In some years it's higher than others. I think these last 2 years was pretty high. I think the year previous to that it was low. So it's, again, it's a gamble. I mean, I know, what do we have, two to three retirements this year that we know of?
Yes, and unfortunately, I believe two of them are budget cuts.
That's right.
So
those don't count.
Would you let us double count them?
Preferably not in a balanced budget.
I'll try.
So, yeah, so that would be my thought process on it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Did you have something?
She's been waiting.
Okay.
I just wanted to say that I think Dr. Nyan indicated administration was 10%. It's actually 2%. And maybe Mr. Lovin has additional comments, because unless somebody, I was going to actually make a motion, but I think maybe he is.
Yeah.
I'm ready, though, to make a motion when we're done.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, the administration figure that I think Dr. Nyan was looking at is in figure 20. It's the first row of administration for FY18, 754K.
I'm sorry, can you give us a page?
Sure, I'm sorry. Page 35. It's kind of the master table of the whole budget. And maybe I misread that. But
administration.
Upper right corner. And that's just staffing by cost center. It's not total. 754 is what I see in the upper right.
Okay.
Pages. So 75 seemed like 10% of 754.
Oh, I got what you're doing. Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. And to Elaine's point earlier, page 34, I was one in this neighborhood. We have a graph in figure 19 that shows the amount of school budget returned to town at end of fiscal year. If we decide to pursue this request for a loan from FinCom, I would ask if we could have insight into what, you see some variability here, right? These numbers go from 118,000 up to 590,000. I'll tell you, the 590 looks a lot better to me than the 118, but I know there's a lot of different circumstances in each year. So can we get any insight about what we're thinking this graph might look like for this FY18, or do we really, really not know?
I could try to answer it. Gary's proposal about the, it's a very complicated question. And there's a lot of variables that go into that. The year that it was 590 was a year that there were out-of-district placements. Most of that came from special education. And I believe it was your... It wasn't your first budget.
No. It was pre-me.
But there was out-of-district placements that were budgeted that did not come to fruition, which was a good thing. So that funding was given back to the town reserves. There are at times differences in costs when teachers are hired. I think it's very risky, and I think you use the word risky for a very simple reason, is that what happens is, especially in positions that may be in high demand, sometimes positions come in higher than the person that left. So then you're actually running in a negative. So that could be a problem. But the other thing is sometimes you have unanticipated circumstances that occur during the year. And I will go into an example without getting too specific. This year, we did have a person, a non-represented individual, that was out for over a year, but crossed two fiscal years. And the person, we couldn't leave the position vacant. And we actually had to hire another person at a little bit lower salary, but it was still a salary. It's not like a long-term sub-salary that we could use. So we were actually carrying two salaries for a while. So sometimes those savings have to go to those circumstances.
The last piece of this that I don't want to get in the habit of is to limit the building principals when they are hiring and tell them that they need to hire a person that's cheaper, not necessarily the one that is the best candidate, because I think you go down a dangerous road with that. When you look at retirements, you can get a little savings in retirement, and I think there was one, maybe in the second highest year. We did have a large number of retirements that year, and that's why the number's higher. Next year, we only have, I think, two or three retirements. And so, you know, you're not going to get a lot of savings from that. So I hope I captured.
No, it's very helpful. And to be clear, I'm not suggesting we pay for, we get rid of these cuts with such money. I'm talking about how we would repay the loan that we're contemplating requesting. So it's, as a borrower, how do we explain our creditworthiness, if you would? So there is, as I understand it, you know, quite a bit of variability here, but there clearly, in some years, has been opportunity to access some additional funds that could, in theory, be used to repay a loan from this arrangement. Thank you.
Anything else from the committee? Oh, I will get to the public. I truly, truly will. I know that you're not the only person. I will. Promise. Anybody else from the...
I have a separate cut.
Oh, do you want to discuss it?
Sure.
Okay.
So, on Gary's point, another thing I looked at, and again, to as Gene had said earlier, none of this approached the level of savings that would undo a substantial number of these FTE cuts, but... Another thought thing that I'd done was I looked at the building-based budget funds, and I know these play an important role in a number of respects for principals running their schools. One thing I did mathematically was I looked at the FY12 level of these building funds, and I applied the consumer price index from 2013 to 2016, and I came up with a number that was 10% less. So one idea was harvesting $68K from all of these funds in total. And suggesting that, but 10% of 682,000, so it's about 68,000. So it's another small cut, but you know, I was hoping that with other people's ideas, we might be able to come up with a collection of alternative ideas that would be more beneficial to students.
I think I'd like to give a little bit of response to that and just a reaction to it. Building-based budgets was absolutely an area that I looked at very, very carefully as well. It's interesting, I think Dr. Nyan, you suggested a 15% cut, you were looking at a 10%. The most I was comfortable with was 5%. And I would not feel comfortable recommending it. The reason is certainly the high school took a cut this year in their building-based budget. They've already taken a cut. In this proposal, the high school took a cut. So I certainly would not advocate for additional cutting there. And the fact is, at the elementary level, that no Atom consumable stuff is really expensive. And the feedback from teachers and the feedback from parents has been so powerful, and we have new frameworks, and the new test is coming in 3 years, that this, to me, goes to stability in the system. It's very easy on paper to cut it 5%, 10%, it's, you know, and it yields tens of thousands of low tens of thousands of dollars too, just for the record, not even half of a position. So for me, it was a thought process I had, and I thought to hamstring our, I don't even know if that's the right expression, to handcuff our principals so much and not be able to afford the materials they need to do the job to save 30K when our problem is this huge, just seemed short-term to me, but I hear the thinking, and God knows I went down it too. I think the only other one I would want to respond to, because it's a question I heard, and I think it's one that's going to come up, is the idea of the literacy coach. And I'll tell you why I thought about it personally. That was certainly on my list, and I'll tell you why I'm comfortable defending keeping it in the budget. Two main reasons. One is the grade 3 ELA scores we saw this year were highly concerning. And the second is the Eaton Level 3 status. That is the elementary school that houses the LLD program, which is specifically language-based learning disabilities. And we heard in November from Principal Sprung that the literacy coach was working really thoroughly in the Eaton School, and I just am not comfortable pulling language support resources from that school this year. But I hear you, and I think it's one, I think it's a question that's going to come up, so I think it's a good one to have thought through as a committee.
The other area that was an area of a lot of thought was the combined professional development spend levels that are not controlled by applicable contracts or legal requirements. So quite a bit of our professional development spend is a little confusing to follow until you have it explained to you, but you know, well over 700,000 of that is teacher salary, and so that's not something that's being discussed here. If you looked at the other areas, you know, I contemplated anything from a 25% to a 75%, of what's left. To Jean's point, you end up maybe 20 to 60K savings. I couldn't find a way to make that really make a substantial impact on the overall picture we're looking at, and it comes at a cost to the people who are benefiting from that training, which I recognize as well. We do have curriculums. It takes a number of years to implement these in the classroom, and we have a new science curriculum from some grades last year. So again, it's a destabilizing cut to those people that are benefiting from those dollars spent. So unless it was going to achieve some kind of magnificent offsetting benefit for students, which I'm so far not hearing from all the other ideas we've heard, I wonder whether this would be something that would be productive and not just destabilizing.
Agree.
Just for clarity, everything that Jean said, she thought of regarding the literacy coach, I thought of as well. And I'm trying to avoid going into discussions about it in any great detail, only because I don't think we necessarily have to at this point. It might happen down the road.
Right.
And I don't think it will be anything but really divisive to do that. You asked if we had ideas, I just threw them out. And I would rather not have to go back and forth, because there could be arguments both ways, and I don't think we need to do it at this point.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Nye. Dr. Nye.
I just, to the per pupil, I just sort of want to look at that, because if you go all the way back to 2012, yes, but you have to understand, we've been cutting the budget for 4 years, and we did that in the per pupil. So if you go back to FY14, it was actually higher than the current total per pupil.
I actually showed a slide on another meeting.
Right, so, and then...
It's in the question.
Oh, it's in the question.
Right, I was looking that up. Right, so I believe, so I just want to... You know, and then in FY16, we took it down to 586. So yes, it's up from FY16 to 17. It's flat 17 to 18. But the reason it's up from 16 to 17 is because we were ravaging that to avoid other things. So I think it's, whether you go all the way back, and then FY11, by the way, right, it was 685, which that's, so in FY11, it was $3,000 higher than it is now. And the downward times in the per pupil is because we were trying to avoid other cuts. That's what this category has been used for. So I think you have to be careful when you pick a point in time and sort of look at a percent. So I just wanted to comment.
I actually have something connected to that, Mrs. Webb. I had asked Dr. Dr. I think I might have asked you for that information.
You did.
and my reasoning was I wanted to see how it had changed over time. And in conversations with you, you said that it's pretty much been stable for at least 10 years. And when I thought about that, and I recognize we're in a very low inflationary environment, but the fact is that over time, I mean, probably as a budgeting practice, we should be going in the other direction with this. I mean, if we had the revenue and if we weren't constantly struggling to keep level services, probably the better approach would be to build in a 1.5% escalator every year and say, okay, principals, you get this amount, and every year there'll be a little bit of a bump up to address inflation. I'm certainly not recommending it tonight. We certainly can't afford it. But I think I'm making the same point as you, Mrs. Webb.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure we're checking this scorecard here, too. In figure 2, 3, and 4 of the budget, up on page 3, right, these are all of, I think, most of the cuts. There may be, Dr., is this everything here, these three tables that you're proposing?
What pages?
I'll make sure I have it.
Three.
Pages
two and three.
3 and 4. So this should be, this is our roadmap, right? So Mr. Robbins's proposal goes to, as I, just a very small number of these items, right? So it goes to the kindergarten paraeducators for 50K. It goes to the elementary school teachers, 105K, which is affected by the change in enrollment. So it's not actually a cut we need to make, could make, don't need to. And of course, the 438K for the middle school teachers. So that, to my math, and if I was wrong before with my math, you better check me. It's around 40% of the money here. And maybe the accountant can check, but you know, it's not anywhere near all of the total cuts that are here.
40% of the cuts?
Yes, of the cuts, right. So are we saying, I haven't heard any comments on the other 60% of the money here. Are we saying that are there any other comments on all these other proposed reductions that are here?
I've been thinking that exact question. And I think what it shows, we would not like to make any of these cuts. Let's start with that. So to your point, we would like to not make any of them. I think the middle school one, for the reasons that people have talked about from a systemic perspective, unmantling a program that potentially, if the fiscal environment changed in a year, we wouldn't need to. I think we all have a kind of general negative rate. We have a desperation about saving that so that that doesn't happen. I do. I am getting comfortable with this idea because on the one hand, we're asking the finance committee and the town to support a very big infusion to support our schools for 1 year. So it's a big ask. And I do think that a good faith effort to, I guess I think it's as much as we can ask for.
Are we prepared for the question, what about next year? So the Cubs won the World Series this year. That's great for some of us, but it's not going to happen every year. So we have a contingency, positive contingency, if we receive revenue from an override that settles this, how we resolve this loan. But I want to make sure we're prepared for that and get people's thoughts on that. And then secondly, just to, what if we get the question, is this for operating revenue? Right, are you asking for funds to run your shop rather than for a one-time thing? So the science curriculum, 150K for part two, but we've still got part three to go.
Mm-hmm.
438K for not restructuring the middle school, which is, I think, unique on this sheet and being a structural,
yep,
I think, harm to students that would be very difficult to unwind and very difficult to unwind late in the game. The later we wait to do this, the more likely it's going to be more and more difficult to change back to a longer day, retain the people we need to, and get everybody geared up for what would have been a year that looked a lot like this year. So those are my questions.
So I don't know whether you're asking me, but I'll so that's to your question of whether it's operating or whether it's a one-time, that's part of the negotiation with the FinCom. That's not something that I've decided tonight. I mean, I'd like it to be a one-time and then the override, but that's up to all of us to decide how we want to approach the FinCom on that, because we could do it either way. I think there's other things that we're still working on that, you know, leave it at that, and so.
I don't know if this is appropriate now, but I'd just like to make a motion to close discussion and to just go with what Mr. Robinson has come up with, and I don't really see the value of going into it in detail, further cuts or going back and forth in terms of the value of all of these cuts. I'd just like to, personally, that's my opinion.
So I will accept that motion if there's a second, but that does not mean discussion ends. For people who've been waiting to speak, a motion on the table and then a second, discussion can continue. So I will absolutely call for public comment.
I don't mean.
You meant like you were, just you felt that the committee was good.
Committee.
Linda.
I had my hand up.
Certainly. Was that a second?
I seconded.
So just for the minutes, we have a motion for Mr. Nyhan to adopt Mr. Robinson's proposal in total.
Oh, that would be very nice.
It's the budget. It's the new bottom line budget.
That would be very nice.
So the bottom line budget is $41 million.
You have to make this motion.
Okay.
Well, if you want to.
$41,889,661.
Can you do that again?
One more time.
$41,000,000.
Gotta go slow.
Yeah, I'll pass the sheet to you.
That would be good.
Passing notes.
Thank you.
Don't you get in trouble?
But he can refer to the particular, you couldn't possibly read all that in a motion, just the strategy proposed by Mr. Robinson.
Yep.
Okay.
Wait. I have something else to add. Are we voting on the actual budget?
You can make an amendment.
Okay.
Yep.
So I make a motion that we go forth with a budget to our town manager of $41,889,661.
And second?
Second.
Okay, and we will have discussion continue.
I have one more thing to suggest that would raise this number modestly.
So what that is I'd like to make a...
Can I do that later?
I'd like to make a friendly amendment.
Okay, thank you.
Go ahead.
Sorry, Dr. Doxer, you've been very patient.
When we were asked about creative revenue sources, I know I asked the question in the book about the issue of the RISE, the 0.5 cut in a RISE teacher that was going to be filled by a high school teacher. So it's sort of a hit to the high school. And I did ask the question about raising the tuition for RISE to cover that one. And I think I was trying to look for the answer. I think that the answer was that it might push us out of the competitive range for RISE. And I wonder with the waiting list that we already have, the quality of the program that it is, the convenience of being in our own town, whether that could outweigh the fact that it might be on the more expensive side, especially given our finances right now. So would we really lose that many students if we were on the more expensive side of such a stellar preschool program that fed directly into the schools that the children will be in?
Thank you, Dr. Doxer. Yes, please.
I think we looked at a 5% increase and a 10% increase. So the 5% increase is what is in this proposal, mm-hmm. this proposed budget. If you went with a 10% increase, that probably would cover the $30,000. I guess I would ask Mrs. Butts probably to speak to the waiting list piece, because I know you're about to do a lottery in a week or so, and there's a pretty big waiting list.
Thank you. Anything else from the committee?
Other than
can
you mention supporting that?
If you want to.
She says there wasn't any
pushback.
There wasn't any
pushback
on the
5%. Oh, yeah.
Right,
yeah.
I didn't hear her answer very well.
Okay. Can you just repeat the answer that Mrs. Butts just gave?
I can speak louder.
That'd be great.
Yeah, could you just, sorry, I didn't really hear you.
It over 800.
A lot of people that are interested in coming to RISE despite that.
Where does that put us?
And so I would support that as well, that increase of the tuition. And I also, having taught down there, recognize the significance of the value of music and movement at that grade level. And I think it takes a unique expertise in music education to teach down there. I don't know if you can necessarily have the high school teacher go down there and necessarily be as effective as what you probably have now, so I would strongly endorse that.
A concern I have is that we were required to send out applications before the budget process, just as a matter of calendar and what happened. So the solution was Dr. Doherty and his staff believed this was a potential increase, so the application said pending school committee approval. I would have concerns about going out to those families now and saying not only did the school committee approve that fee increase, surprise, I would have some concerns about kind of truth in advertising, and that just, I have a kind of a visceral reaction to that, which doesn't mean that I don't think it might be something to explore in the future.
On this topic still?
Are you on this topic?
No, it, is this on the same topic?
It is.
Go ahead.
So I'm talking about the reductions with Ms. Robbins's proposal, or did you want to talk about rise, right? Okay, so go ahead. Thank you.
So I just wanted to clarify, so we had in the questions and answers book, page 45. We had the current and proposed amounts, so I just sort of want to clarify what Mrs. Doxer is proposing, and Mr. Nyan spoke about, and we heard from Mrs. Butts, is that the current, like for the 5 full days, the current rate is 750, it would be 825 instead of the 790. Just want to make sure I'm understanding this correctly. That's what we're talking about. It would go from 600 a month to 630 instead, 660 for the 4 days. Okay, so we're talking about then the programs costing between 825 and 265, about 263, correct? I just want to make sure I'm understanding what that increase would mean. Okay, so I don't know why I want to put this in my head the way that my kids were, just sort of thinking about it. I can't imagine what we paid in, I don't know, 1999. But so somebody paying 280 a month, it could go up to 310. And the question is that going to be have a negative impact versus right now they're thinking that their 280 a month is going to go up to 300, right? So I'm trying to look at the numbers to get a sense of whether this is the right or wrong thing to do.
Anything else from the committee? And there are people in the audience who I think are very eager to weigh in.
I just want to make sure I'm following the math here on Mr. Robinson's proposal. Just make sure we've all got this right of what we're proposing. So we've got everything in figure 4 is it. Everything in figure 3 is it. 288.
Remind us of your
wait.
Page 4.
Page 4.
Page 4.
I want to make sure we know what I know what I'm doing when I raise my hand.
Page 4.
Figure 2.
So the proposal, we've got the cuts laid out before us. Figure two is personnel, figure three is non-personnel, figure four is changing offsets.
Yep.
Non-personnel reductions, they stay, 288,405, correct? No changes there, I haven't heard anyone change those.
Figures. Why am I looking at 163?
163,405 plus 125.
So oh, you added these two. Okay.
I hope I did.
Plus,
yeah. That was my intent. And then I go over to figure two, and we're reversing the kindergarten paraeducators, 3.3 FTA for 50K. So we're not doing that. We're not doing the 438K for middle school teachers at 7 FTE, right? And how are we counting the elementary classroom teachers? Because that's a cut we don't need to make, but is it effectively something we're not doing here?
So you don't need as many teachers.
Understood.
So it's not.
So for the purposes of math and determining our final budget, do we count this as a reduction or not?
You do.
What's currently in the budget would stay because we had taken out the two people. It was just if you wanted to bring it down by two more people and use that funding to go somewhere else. So it's a net.
I'm not sure that's, I may be misunderstanding both of you, but I'm not sure that's the question Nick is asking. I think what he's asking is he's trying to come to what is the new reduction in personnel? If we adopt Mr. Robinson's proposal, what's the new reduction in personnel? And his question is, should we just not count that 105 or should we? And I think we should. Those are two positions that are currently budgeted in FY17 that we will be cutting in FY18. We're not, no, when I say cutting, yes.
That is correct, yes.
Not through, not through layoffs and not
Through attrition.
Yes. So I understand from the educational and impact, but from a financial impact, we will still be cutting $105,000 from the budget.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, so you should include that in your calculations. Thank you.
All right, so I get the number of $545,000 for remaining personnel reductions.
Can you say that again?
$545,000 even is what I get.
I'll double check it out.
Okay. And then we add the $288,405, and we get $833,405. The $288,000 was from the other page.
I think you're going, everyone down here can't understand you. You're gonna have to slow it way down.
All right, so
Well, I just, can you get the $288,000 again? I'm sorry.
Yeah, I've just added $163,405, figure three and figure four. These are the non-personnel reductions. So I just wanna make sure we're making the correct proposal. So this is a loan that we're, loan package we're putting together here, a request. And we're doing something else here too, right? And Jean, this was a separate agenda item as I understood it. We're adding something in here that is not a cut. It's more spending. It's $150K to implement the science curriculum year two.
Yep.
So that's a different animal, right?
Yep.
So do we wanna talk about those ideas now with Dr. Nyhan's motion pending, or how do we wanna handle that?
You can just, you can say anything you'd like.
Go right on, okay. So we have $150K there too. So Gail, is that in our number? We've got $833,405 remaining reductions from level service. And then we're adding in $150,000 in spending. So I just wanna make sure that when we finally get to vote on what the final number is that we're gonna pass on, and maybe we come back to this another time to allow.
Included the $150,000. So it's the existing budget that we had presented plus the $438,000 plus the $150,000 are the only, the paras wash themselves because you would increase the fee and increase the offset.
Okay, so you've accounted for all the remaining cuts that are reductions that were in the superintendent's recommended budget, figure two, figure three, figure four in your number. Just wanna make sure we're on the same page.
Yes.
Literally.
So figure three and figure four were in the
recommended
budget that we provided. Thank you.
Which was $40,847,666.
I guess I have to make an amendment then to suggest that we raise the tuition for our wonderful RISE program to offset that cut, so that that is not a cut that we will be making.
So that's 10%.
Yes.
To increase the, from go to 5 to 10%
because
increase.
That would cover that $30,000, right?
That is correct. I just want to make sure that.
Yes.
And I want to make sure that I'm clear on where we're at. We have a motion to adopt Mr. Robinson's proposal. Is there a second on that amendment?
Yes.
A
second from Dr. Nyhan.
No.
Wait, we already did
second.
That.
No, on the
I amendment. Second. Wait.
Yeah,
what?
We need to vote.
Wait a minute. We
right now we're doing Linda's amendment on
oh,
RISE
sorry.
Tuition.
Okay.
Linda's
amendment.
Linda. Yes, thank you. Linda
thank you.
Made the amendment. Dr. Nyhan seconded the amendment. I would like to. I'd like the committee now to give me a sense of how many amendments we can expect, because if it's a whole bunch, we're going to have to take a different process. If it's one more, we can do this all in one fell swoop. So, Mr. Blavin has an amendment. Does anyone else in the committee anticipate having an amendment at this point? All right,
no.
Mr. Blavin.
So my amendment would be a proposal to freeze and not raise the caps on athletics and extracurriculars. So we would not be raising that. Gail, I believe you priced that around $8,500, but.
For the athletics, yes.
For the athletic, and the extracurricular was very small, but would you, is $8,500 reasonable to budget for that combined? So the individual caps would go up, I'm sorry, the individual fees would go up as indicated in the superintendent's proposed budget, but the family caps would not go up.
That is an estimate based upon prior year numbers, because we don't have full year this year. So there is a, depending if the numbers come in higher this year, free or reduced, it could be a higher number.
But on the best available information, it's $8,500 is the cost.
Yeah.
So I would propose to make a corresponding cut to the building fees overall for an equal amount. So out of $682,000, I would propose an $8,500 reduction in aggregate, shared according to the formulas, per pupil formulas.
So decrease the per pupils by the $8,500?
So you would take the $682,000 and change that is in all of the combined 8 building budgets. And my proposal is to reduce that by $8,500 in aggregate. The share that each school would feel of that reduction would be proportional to their current per pupil number. And the result would be that no family would have to pay more in aggregate for athletics and extracurriculars than they did in FY17. Thank you.
I just want to make sure I understand it, because I'm taking notes. I understand the cutting the fees by the principal's per building fees by a total of $8,500.
Right.
And your objective is to use that money. Can you repeat what you said about the athletic family cap?
So we're spending more money by freezing these fees. We're spending $8,500. And rather than asking FinCom for that money, I'm asking the building principals for that money by reducing the $682,000 by $8,500 and then sharing that among the 8 buildings in proportion to whatever their current ratios are. We have responses.
Yeah, please.
Yes.
Please.
To make it slightly
please.
Cleaner?
Cleaner would be good.
Cleaner, yes. So.
Same cost center.
Same cost center?
Sure.
So slightly different number. So if we decrease, yeah, if we don't increase the cap, we would have to decrease the offset within the athletics. We were able to, if Tom was here, I would thank Tom. We were able to renegotiate
the pool
rate,
yes,
which is about a savings of $6,100. My suggestion would maybe just to say we budget $6,100 per family cap, offset it with the pool, keep it all within athletics.
That's fine.
And get to the same place.
I like that idea.
Okay, so now this is where I need, I was about to say, I need a Robert's Rules person, so. If you would like, would you like to withdraw your motion? Your amendment, let me rephrase that.
Yes.
So we're.
They're making the adjustment in the, you're doing.
Well, I would withdraw the amendment, but propose an amendment that, a different amendment. But we're not raising the. We're, I want to make clear that we're not, we're agreeing not to raise the family caps for athletics. Okay, does that have to be changed?
That does have to be an amendment.
That's in the budget now. So my proposal would be, if I understand Gail correctly.
To not raise the cap.
To not raise the cap for athletics or extracurriculars. And I'm including all extracurriculars in that. And pay for that by, Gail, please give me the right language here.
We would pay for it in the savings we have achieved in what, right now, a fact certain, we know the pool rates have been decreased and we have heard that the ice rates are not going up. So we have savings within the athletics.
So as a result of strong negotiating skills on the part of the team at this table, from
very
Dr. Darty's team.
That team.
We have achieved, Team Darty has achieved a reduction in swimming that has frozen the caps on athletics
and
extracurricular.
And ice.
So,
and ice.
And ice. And we are thankful for that. Thank you.
And you're saying family cap.
Family cap only.
Not
family
individual.
Only.
I just want to make that clear.
That would be a much
right,
yes.
right. But the family cap. So the individual. And there's a second from Dr. Nyan. So we have a motion and 2 amendments on the table.
I just want to highlight that I would not have supported that because that would have been taking money out of our core academics, our very, very slim per pupil budgets.
But we're not doing
it. I know, it's contrary to some of the input we heard, and I'm very pleased that there was good negotiation.
I just want to clarify that our public will be able to speak before we take any votes.
I think I said that.
Okay.
I hope I said that. Yes.
We're having trouble keeping track of the
amendments. I just want to get it. I don't want anyone to think that we're adding that science in. It's something we have now. So I just, because it's not shown in the cuts, I don't want people to think it's a new program or something. All right.
I think that's a really good point, Mr. Robertson. It's the year 2 that we that we committed to a three-year implementation.
Right.
That's a very good point.
It wasn't a cut, but you stated that.
I'm sorry, Ms. Duncan.
Sorry. It wasn't a cut, but you stated publicly in the beginning of the whole process that we were not going to add that.
We were not going to fund it, right.
So in a sense, it's a cut.
So I'd love to take some public comment and input at this point, unless anyone in the committee has anything additional. Yes, thank you, sir. Yeah, approach the microphone over here, please, and if you could state your name and street, that would be very helpful.
Good evening. My name is Michael DiGiorgio. I live on Curtis Street. I've got a number of points that I've just been jotting down over the night, so I apologize if this is a little bit lengthy, but and just maybe the time of the night and I'm hungry, but I just find it a little bit frustrating that we're talking about allocating where $8,500 are relative to fees and capping costs, and it's like arranging the chairs on the Titanic, where we have much bigger problems to solve. With that said, I also feel that, and I agree with Ms. Snow-Dodd, that, you know, borrowing money at this stage is not a sustainable opportunity, not a sustainable option. Unfortunately, I think people have short-term memories, and it will get through that point where, oh, you guys were able to squeeze out, you know, you guys were able to, you know, massage things at the last second because you are talented people. And there's no mistaking that, but we're going to end up with this problem again next year. And I think by making it, not that you have a choice to make it painful or less painful, but we as a community are in this situation together. This is something that we've made for ourselves. So I think the time is now to not ask for a loan. I like the idea of coming back with a unbalanced budget and let the finance committee figure out ways to solve that. But the idea of quoting it, structuring it like a loan, it just bothers me. If the finance committee wants to give the school committee free cash, that's different, all right? But that's up to them to decide. I'd also like to say that as a parent of a RISE student and a parent of hopefully a RISE, my second child going to RISE, I'd be more than happy to have additional fee. I don't mind paying the additional fee, even after we already have the notification that it's going up 5%. I agree with the points that the wait list is long, and it's long for a reason, because the quality of the education is bar none. So you pay what you get for. You get what you pay for, excuse me. So I think it's not outrageous to add the additional 5%. And I guess my last comment, which is really more of a question, with the, we're trying to save, there were comments to the fact that removing the middle school teachers would be devastating to the program, the language program, and I can understand that. But we're talking about seven FTEs at $438,000. Is it an all or nothing number that we feel is devastating? And actually, I'm sorry, I'll just finish my thought and then I'll let you answer. Reason why, if it isn't an all or nothing, right, why don't we look at pulling from other programs that would be less devastated if they were reduced this year? I mean, again, I don't like the idea of reducing anything, but you mentioned athletics, $200,000. And I'm not recommending we get rid of it, but you know, taking that $200,000, I think it would be less impactful to rebuild that, use that money to bring in half of the 3.5 FTEs, take less of an impact on the language program. And, you know, again, unfortunately, it's kind of the, you know, borrowing today, borrowing from Peter to pay Paul. But I'm just trying to understand why, you know, is the seven FTEs an all or nothing thing? And if it is that impactful, what other areas are not, can we look at that won't be as impactive? Thank you.
Clearly a long deliberation. We haven't voted yet. Dr. Doherty, do you want to take that? There's at least one part I want to address, but.
The middle school piece has to be looked at as a whole package because it puts back the entire middle school structure. The only way you could change the structure is to take all of those seven FTE out. In order to put it back in, you have to put all seven back in. So we had to get to the schedule that we would be proposing. You would have to cut a subject out of each of the three grades, and that's where you get the seven. Thank you.
And I wanted to address the hypothetical I gave way earlier in the evening about the athletics, because I want to be 100% clear on this. The point I was trying to make was that the absolute most we could get out of athletics is about $200,000. And let me be clear, the cost of that is not a single athletic program in the Reading Public Schools. So I don't want anyone to think that there is $200,000 to be saved. There definitely is not. The absolute most we could get is $200,000, and that means no football team, no soccer team, no swim team, no sports at all. And that my point was that's something I could never in a million years advocate for, particularly because, to your point, even if you decimated it, which would have just unimaginable impact in the community and on our students, still doesn't even come close to solving the problem, you know? So that was the point I was trying to make with that. More to correct a perception I've heard in the community that that's an area we could tackle. I just don't see that it is. Thank you for the questions. Ms. Perry and then Mr. Arena.
Paula Perry, and I am sort of talking with my FinCom hat on. I just want to clarify, as you were talking about, you often give back some money at the end of the year, and it can vary, and you were talking like that to start some of the loan payback. I do want to clarify so we don't double count things. That's built into our assumption of regeneration, so you just want to be careful double counting things, that's all. So that's really already built into the formula of regenerating $1 million a year. And that's why we're comfortable using $1 million out of free cash. We expect it to basically be a wash and regenerate.
Ms. Perry, I know you've been at a million meetings. I've seen you at them all. And for that kind of input is exactly why I'm so glad that you do. Thank you. That perspective only someone at FinCom could have brought. So thank you. No, if you could times it by 20, we'd be all set. Thank you. Mr. Arena.
Good evening. John Arena, Reading Board of Selectmen. Just call me John. Mr. Arena is my dad. You can't do a loan. There's really no practical way to do a loan. Think about it. It's like borrowing a dollar today and offering to pay it back with the $2 I give you next year. The schools don't have any money that the town doesn't give them. What you could do is make a one-time request of FinCom and ultimately town meeting. However, what I'm hearing here tonight is a suggestion that some of that might be operating funds, and the prospect of using free cash for operating funds is not the way it's used. It also opens up, I think, a problem, pardon me?
That's not true. We're using the money right now to balance the $1 million that's being used for operating funds.
That was a decision by FinCom. This would now set a precedent where an out of balance budget goes to FinCom for balance. You can certainly do it. I'm not saying you can't do it, but imagine if the town did the same thing and said, we've got to go get 8 cops paid for. Why don't we make an adjustment? It just sets a precedent, and this would be the second year of such a precedent. What you could do is look for one-time things. For example, the science curriculum. I believe the town manager's already offered at a previous date to fund the second tranche of science curriculum. There might be other one-time events that would be justified as well. But I think opening up a conversation to funding operating expenses through the free cash path is really a bit of an end around. It's fine on a one-time basis, perhaps. Maybe there's enough stretch in it, but it's It just sets a precedent. I think the school is obligated to submit a budget, and the town manager is obligated to balance it. I think at the end of the day, it may simply be that you do the best you can, you submit what you can, and by all means, talk to town meeting, excuse me, talk to FinCom. If this were to pass at April town meeting, that's one outcome, but you have to plan that it may not pass, and you're right back where you are tonight. So you actually have to have almost, you have to have two outcomes. You know, again, it's an A and a B problem. But I think the prospect of treating it as a loan, it doesn't compute. There's no way for you to pay it back except for money that you'd get out of next year's budget that you'd turn right around and hand back. So it would just add to next year's budget. It's really no way to do what you're describing, I don't believe. Thank you.
John, it was described as a loan to the override, to an override. In other words, if an override is put on the ballot, we would commit that part of that over, which we've done before, part of that override money would go back to, or would go to free cash.
You'd almost have to say that you define the next budget without paying it. You define a forthcoming budget that had no repayment element, and then that budget would be diminished by the repayment. But you'd have to do that in advance so everyone could be convinced that the repayment was actually reduced as opposed to simply grossing up next year's budget, if you follow what I mean. You'd have to actually take the cost of repayment, to use a bad word, out of the following budget, and therefore you'd be underfunded in the following year as well. It'd be another tough year.
And as I said to Mr. Blavin earlier, that will be part of what we need to determine, whether it's a one-time or whether it goes into the base. And I think you just mentioned that, you know, we can't call it a loan if it goes into the base. So.
And just to amplify the comments made by Paula, all of the unspent dollars flow back into free cash, and I don't think there's any vehicle by which they're withheld that I know of. I think they flow back, they're unspent, and that's the vehicle by which recharging occurs. So I'm not sure what guidance I can give you. I don't believe what you're doing is actually practical. I think your best way to approach it is to try to allocate propose that one-time items like the science curriculum might possibly be candidates, discuss that with FinCom, but putting so much of the operating, even here tonight, I'm hearing, what about growth, adding back here, adding back there? I think putting that in front of town meeting, I don't know how that discussion goes, and if it fails, you're right back where you are tonight.
I think you bring up a really good point, Mr. Arena. If it fails, we are right back where we are, and I think that the decision, if we were to make it, to pass an unbalanced budget is no small decision, and it would communicate that the school committee is unwilling to endorse a budget that decimates the middle schools in this way.
Exactly. Well said.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nyan. Dr. Nyan. Ms. Williams.
Hi, Alicia Williams, 40 Marla Lane. In regards to 10% tuition increase for the RISE, applications have gone out, and I think that it would kind of, you know, they've said that there's a 5% increase on them, and I think it would be kind of a slap in the face to the parents that have budgeted for this school and for this increase. Although I personally would pay a great sum of money to send my child to RISE, at this point, it's going to leave a really bad taste in people's mouth, not to mention the chaos that I think it would cause for Miss Debbie's office and for Denise to kind of have to call all those parents and say, listen, we said 5%, we were just kidding, it's gonna be 10%. I think it's gonna maybe anger some of the residents in Reading, and I just wanted to say that. Thank you.
Any other comments? Mr. Corum.
Jeffrey Corum, Ridge Road. I think I have to agree with Mr. Robinson's proposal to ask for more money from free cash. I mean, I pointed out yesterday, you know, and as did you, that even if you take that money out, there's still, you know, there's something over $1 million of free cash above the 7% that the FinCom has asked to keep in there. to Mr. Arena's point, sorry, to John's point, we did regenerate $3 million in free cash last year. Part of that was about $1.5 million in revenue that came in above projections. So to some extent, by projecting conservatively, the town has really clamped the school committee's ability to fund its the proper operation. So to say you can only use this money for one-time expenses, when if you had budgeted for more into the if you had budgeted revenues higher so that you weren't regenerating it as free cash, but as part of the actual revenues, you would have that money to spend as part of the operating budget. Mm-hmm. So I don't see that is such a big problem to be taking this for operating budget for free cash. And I also think that Mr. Robinson's correct that if you're looking at 8-point-something million dollars in free cash, it's a hard sell to go out to the voters and say, we need to take more money from you, we need to raise your taxes, because this $8 million, oh, we can only use that for one-time things, and we haven't found enough one-time expenses to spend it on, so we're just gonna let it sit there because it makes us feel more comfortable at night. I can't see going to explain to these three kids here, I'm sorry, one of you will not be able to take foreign language next year. You had half a year in seventh grade. You're not going to get that other half year in eighth grade. You'll have an easy time in ninth grade when you retake level one of French or Spanish. And all those sixth graders out there, 300 students, sorry, you don't get foreign language next year. I think that's really tough to do because we want to keep this free cash for one-time expenses. I support Mr. Robinson's proposal.
Thank you, Mr. Corum. Yes, thank you for your patience. I know you've been wanting to speak.
Brian O'Mara, Batch Elder Road. I just have one question. It's more clarification. And Mr. Robinson, thank you for the proposal. I appreciate it. It's encouraging. But the return of the two elementary positions, I thought I understood it at the beginning based on the budget assumptions, but then I was unclear on it again after some of the conversation. Could you explain what that is? Because initially I thought those positions were coming back, but it clearly sounds like that's not the case. Well, can you provide detail on that? I'm just trying to explain
this. Do you want to take this,
Dr.
Daugherty?
They are coming back.
Okay. That's good news. I just want to be able to tell people that. So,
good news. And just to add to it, based on current enrollment projections, right, we can't make any promises, but the retention of those two positions at this point looks like all elementary classes next year will be within school committee guidelines, which is something we did not know if we would be able to do for one more year. And I would say for one more year. I think there's some optimism around this proposal, but I don't lose sight of the fact that this is a one-year solution. This is the beginning of a conversation, not the end.
And to that point, just so I understand, if you were to take this to FinCom and FinCom says no,
yep,
those two positions are still coming back. Those are off the table.
Correct.
All right. Thank you.
Dr. Daugherty, that's my
answer.
Yes, yeah. I just want to make sure I'm clear on that. Yeah, Mrs. Swann.
Right now, we have the 92 teachers, and there's 150,000 here, which is, and that's two retirements.
105.
No, last is 105. And we'll be at 90.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
And that's what we need.
And for folks who didn't see the last meeting, the reason that is acceptable is we've seen a decrease in kindergarten enrollment. Kindergarten and first grade enrollment, so that those positions which were anticipated as being necessary in November, we now know are looking like they are not.
But no one's losing their job.
Correct.
And it will be accomplished through attrition and not through layoffs.
That was all I wanted to say.
Okay. Anything else from the committee or the public? Okay, thank you. I think we need to soldier on.
I just wanted to clarify that I am not necessarily against the loan idea. My point was that I think that we have the passion, the momentum, and I think that I heard last night we have people interested, I hope I'm right, that are interested in working again towards the override solution. And so I don't want to wait a year and lose that and have people saying back to us, well, we found the money and we can do that again. So I just want to clarify that my encouragement of the override sooner is not against asking for the free cash to avoid the cuts of 7 teachers and a language program and the ELA program in the middle school. Amy had her hand. Thank you. Oh, Amy. Thank you.
Amy Cole, Bartlett Circle. I just, kind of tagging along with that, first of all, thank you, Mr. Robinson, for your proposal. Certainly makes me hopeful. But I am concerned about the override component, and I know you can't focus on that. You need to do what's best for the kids to save these programs now. But your proposal did specifically say, you know, going for another override in 12 months, which I know isn't up to the school committee, but I'm interested in why your timing of 12 months, because I am thinking that the people who are motivated now that maybe weren't even paying attention before, when they see that, you know, it looked like it was going to be the end of days and now it's not, they're going to say, like was mentioned, oh, they always find the money, it'll be, you know, in the past. So my concern is, I'm wondering if you said 12 months, because then you will have to do something like this again and more things will be on the table and you will then go for a quick override with people again facing these kinds of cuts.
Yeah. I use the 12 months because I was listening to some of the collective wisdom from the Board of Selectmen last night, and I just think we're putting our backs against the wall, but that's not our decision.
Right.
I mean, if someone wants to put it on for April, that's fine. I mean, I'm just that's my opinion, that I think we need that time to mull.
So it wasn't sort of in conjunction with the budget process, and that you would have a new budget that looked just as dire, if not more, that would motivate people to.
No.
Okay.
May I? And I just want to clarify that you're bringing up some good points. This proposal that Mr. Robinson has brought before the committee is kind of dependent on a lot of things that we do not control.
Right.
Such as, will there be an override? How much will the override be for? Will it be in April? Will it be? That's completely outside of our purview. We're just responding to that's a maybe right now.
Right.
And there's a lot of maybes here. We don't know what FinCom's reaction is going to be. We don't know what the, but you think you're hearing a lot of applause for this. Applaud Mr. Robinson for attempting to try to keep us from falling off this particular brink, which I think there's a lot of consensus around the fact would be devastating.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
I actually heard loud and clear from the selectmen last night that they're looking for us to take a stand, the school committee to take a stand, and to say what we need and what we want in terms of an override. So I think, not tonight.
Talking about the date.
We said we would talk about that after we voted this budget.
I completely agree.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, this budget is challenging enough. Sir, you wanted to speak?
Yes.
Jim Martin, Charles Street. I applaud Mr. Robinson's proposal. I think it's a terrific idea. I think it gives us a chance to sit back and develop a solid business plan going forward. Gives us a chance to review all the necessary items that maybe we'd put forth in an override. And I think it also, I don't know whether you call it motivation, or let's not run around town with our hair on fire. You know, the atomic bomb's not going to drop on us tomorrow, and perhaps some sober thinking and time between overrides. The 1 year, I think, is a good suggestion. If we do it too soon, the perception in town is that the management process has not had enough time to digest all of these budget questions and all of these deficit questions that we have. We have a couple of issues with the library. There's still spending there occurring. We still have some issues with the lawsuits and whatever percentages dunnage is put on top of the settlement, I believe.
Could you repeat that last one?
Is there some percentage added to the settlement for not The high school, the settlement, yes.
Do you want to, I'll attempt and then you can. So the school committee in the fall, God, it seems like a lifetime ago, in the fall, was able to negotiate a settlement with the other side on that. And but we were not empowered to fund it. Town meeting needed to fund it, so we went to town meeting and said this. But the amount, the $6 million, was the complete and total amount. That is it. There's no interest on top of that. Not that.
There was a discussion.
And just for folks in the community, that was voted positively. That settlement has happened. That is a finished thing. Oh, it was paid off. Thank you.
Okay. So just cooler heads prevail. Let's look at this plan. I think it's terrific. I think a 1 year waiting period is not going to devastate the town. If we just shouldn't jump into another override too soon.
I just wanted to thank Paula and John for your guidance tonight. That was very helpful, and I think that, you know, collectively the town can look at what I understand us to be proposing here, which is an unbalanced budget, and it would be unbalanced by the amount of line items that we've discussed tonight and those values. But I want to be clear that we've also, I believe, adopted, unless we have further amendments, about half, a little more than half, of the proposed reductions that were in the original budget. So it's, we've done quite a bit of work to reduce the costs of our schools. Those had negative and detrimental impacts, of course, in the community, and we don't want to forget that either. And I think we also need to make a concerted effort to look forward to the future as soon as this budget season is settled and start thinking about how we're going to approach next year, because, you know, the costs are going to continue to increase. I don't think enough costs are going to go down between now and a year from now that we won't have challenges next year. Thanks.
Thank you. Anything else from the committee? Oh, yes. Would you mind going to the microphone in case we are still being taped?
We're being taped, not
live. Just a quick thank you to all of you. You've done so much work, so many hours. The thoughts, all of the thoughts that you've put into this, it's been wonderful. I just wanted to say thank you. Thank the selectmen as well, because they were amazing last night talking about so many different, you know, I'd never been to a selectmen's meeting, and I appreciated all of their hard work as well. I'm saying thank you on behalf of all the foreign language teachers in the middle schools and in the high school. Because we really appreciate it. And now it's time for everybody to talk to their neighbors and to spread the word, and hopefully things will work out. Thank you.
I want to thank you for what you do for our kids every day. And I do want to clarify that even if we were to go down this road and vote this, it is not funded. That is a discussion for FinCom, so I would not want anyone in the audience or at home to get overly excited that we've solved the problem. It's just an attempt to solve the problem. And to your point, Nick, to solve part of the problem, to solve what we perceive to be the most urgent part of the problem, it certainly doesn't solve it all at all. Anything else tonight? Okay. Really make yourself known if I've ignored you, because I'm trying not to. At this point, does the committee desire more conversation, or are we ready to take up the two amendments in the motion?
I'm ready for the amendments.
I think I'm going to do the amendments first. Mm-hmm. The first amendment is to increase the RISE tuition from 5% to 10% to fund the music teacher, I believe. Is that a reasonable motion?
Yep.
Is there... Linda, I actually need you to make that motion. It's yours, not mine.
Yes. Can we also, a suggestion would be to approve to increase the offset to go into the general fund.
So do it.
And I'm going to have Linda, I'm making a motion that isn't mine. Linda, can you make the motion? If you still would like to.
I definitely would still like to. I'm sorry. I think we're looking at difficult decisions, and again, the least worst decision, and I apologize to those who are counting on RISE, and I hope the extra cost does not deter their their registration. So my amendment would be that I propose that we raise the tuition of RISE preschool 10%, and in so doing, increase the offset that would cover the 0.5 FTE music teacher that is currently slated to be cut. 0.6, sorry. Sorry, 0.6.
Is that an acceptable motion?
You want to increase it an additional 5%. It's already,
oh, it's five, already,
it's
a
already
five.
5% in,
I'm
in
sorry.
The budget. Okay.
So increase the 5% increase by another 5%.
Right, and increase the offset by 30,000.
Yeah, and increase the offset by 30,000.
Yeah. Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Any more discussion on the amendment?
Just to be clear, so that was, we finally gave that amount as a dollar amount, not the percent. It's a 10% increase in the fee 30. And a $30,000 increase in the offset.
An additional 30.
Additional to, from what's in the budget right now. Okay, thank you.
Any?
Could we just get the final dollar value of how much that 10% is?
30,000.
No.
We don't know? Okay, thank you.
Sorry.
But you can calculate.
Any more discussion on this? I've already said that I have concerns about this because applications have already gone out with a certain expectation. I think it's a good idea perhaps for the future, but I just don't think it's the right thing right now. All those in favor of, oh, yeah, Ms.
Okay, I just want to comment that I was at first maybe not convinced, but I think hearing from Debbie Butts, hearing from a parent, and recognizing that this is a pretty dire circumstance, and it would be very bad for someone who can't make that, and it does sound like we won't have empty spaces, we wouldn't be asking what Ms. Robinson is asking if this wasn't the absolute, this is the worst budget, done this for 10 years, this is the worst budget I've ever been through. So I'm gonna support this even though I understand the letters went out.
Yeah. And I appreciate that. I think where I'm coming from is the perspective of public trust. I just think it's important that when we say we're gonna do something district.
Wait a minute, it said, what is it? It said
it's
up to the, it says 5%, but
if approved
if
by the school committee, it's not approved.
Pending school committee approval. We didn't approve it.
We were looking at it that it would be either nothing or 5%. I wasn't thinking nothing or 10%, but I am just.
No, I really appreciate your impact, and I think that's what I'm, you know, we can understand the intricacies and, well, the school committee hasn't voted, and the school committee went in a different direction. I'm a parent. I got that letter. You established a certain expectation, and you just changed it, and I wasn't expecting it. That will happen.
So
and if this saving this position is worth that in the community, then I can deal with it, but that's absolutely gonna happen.
Hi, I'm looking at this from both sides. I'm looking also at this by the imposition on the high school teacher,
yep,
going to the preschool, and I think that our teachers have given and given and given. And I feel apologetic that this changed, but it was dependent on school committee approval. And I had another thought, but I just lost.
Can I just add to that? I think the other thing that this does is it allows us to retain the music teacher who as long as that person isn't uncertain about this district and leaving, it would be retaining the person who's currently been working in this role and supporting working with the young kids versus having a music teacher who's used to working with high school students, working with the very youngest in our district. And I'm not saying that that high school teacher could not do that. I'm just saying that I think it's best for the students to have that kind of consistency. And you know, on the municipal side, I know one of the things that they talked about and their situation with the reduction in their budget and not having to actually reduce as many actual people is very different than ours, so they haven't had to do that, and they have been looking to, how do you maintain the morale of the people who are going to continue to work there? So I think that this is a really small step to maintaining the morale in this program. And I, maybe people will interpret it as that we're not as trustworthy as other members. I don't know. But if that's the case, then I guess I...
Oh, I don't mean individual members. I meant the schools as a group.
The other question I was going to ask was that, as I understand it, there is scholarship help. So if that 5 to 10%, that jump from 5 to 10% were to push someone over the edge, would we be able to help someone?
There's no scholarship. It's qualified by freedom of discipline.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, it's
so
the only way
you shouldn't say, right, you should never say scholarship. We should say,
sorry. So if someone's...
Tuition reduction. They would already be enjoying that benefit right now.
It's a financial qualification-based tuition reduction.
Right.
And
by free
they would probably get it anyway.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Any other discussion from the committee? Ms. Williams.
I just want to say something. My daughter is currently at RISE, and I pay the tuition, and the 5% bump was a big jump for us. I have another one that's going to be going to preschool, and it's going to stretch our budget. If you do the 10% and then you have the override, the potential override, it literally, I'll have to move out of Reading. It's going to decimate me. I know that 10% doesn't sound like a lot, but if you add all these things up over time and the fees that people are looking at, it's getting scary to live in Reading.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. Are we ready for a vote? All those in favor of the proposed amendment on RISE for preschool tuition? All those opposed? The amendment does not pass 3-3. The next amendment is Mr. Boivin's amendment. I'm going to have you make it. It is involving, good luck. I'm going to, it's your amendment.
I
thought that was an amendment.
Gail, could you brief me on how to talk about offsets, please?
Gail, we need you to tell us what amendment he wants to make.
Repeat after me, except I'll repeat after you.
Okay, good.
I'm trying to keep up with all of them so we know at the end of the day. So for the athletics, the proposal is to increase the fee but to keep the family cap where it currently is.
No.
And do you happen to have those numbers available? We could find them in the proposal.
The fee is part of the budget.
We're just going to keep the family cap flat with where it currently is.
To modify the existing budget, your motion is to modify the existing budget to reduce the family cap.
Keep the family
cap.
No, in the budget.
In the budget.
The budget right now.
To its original.
So the budget that exists right now, the motion is to reduce the family cap from what's in the budget right now?
Can we get the numbers? What it is now and what it was before.
Do you know what I mean?
Just so it's very
clear. How about bring the family cap back to 2017
levels? Current levels.
Current levels. There you go.
Yeah. The family
cap. And do we need to talk about offsets to do that?
Yes, we would need
to. Is that a separate motion or the same motion?
Same.
Thank you.
So, and then we would also recommend reducing the athletics offset by the 8250.
And should we use the number 8250 or some language about whatever the resulting cost of the cap and the fee cap change?
We would reduce the offset by
the corresponding amount. How's that?
Yeah.
Because we don't know exactly. So, okay, so I'm going to make a motion to reduce the family cap and the superintendent's proposed FY18 budget to 2017 levels for athletics and to reduce the athletic offset by a corresponding amount.
Is there a second?
Can I just call for you? Said.
Can I get a second just before
second.
You do?
Okay, yes.
Thank you, Dr. Nyan.
If you could clarify, I thought previously you said athletics and extracurricular.
I believe they're separate motions.
Okay.
Any other comments or questions?
I I'm really torn because we're struggling with the revolving account, the athletic revolving account. We found a way to keep it viable because the swimming and the rink are costing us less than we anticipated. So that would be a way to keep that viable and not raise fees on everybody again so soon. But instead, we're not raising the cap on a few people. And I struggle because I know how expensive, for instance, hockey is, and people are used to paying that, those funds. And so I'm struggling with this budget. I just, it's a source of offset that we might have access to when we need it. But I hate making people pay more, so I'm torn.
The total dollar amount is quite small, isn't it?
But
it is about $8,000, so it's a very tiny amount of money for what it's worth.
25 families, I think. Well, 25 families that are affected right now.
We don't have to, my attitude is we don't have to make another cut. We can potentially reduce the burden on families, and it's coming from some savings, and it's a very small amount of money, so I can support it. Any other comments in the committee? All those in favor of the proposed amendment? It passes 6-0. Before we...
Extracurricular, same thing.
Oh.
It's a separate cap.
Then you gotta...
Yep. Gail, I need your help again here. I'm gonna do the same thing, but let me know if there's any differences. Is there a cap for extracurriculars for families right now? Mm-hmm. And is that being raised in the FY18 budget?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm making a motion to reduce the family cap in the superintendent's proposed FY18 budget as it occurs in the school committee budget to FY17 levels, and to reduce the, no offsets, just
no
reduce
offsets.
The cap.
Just mm-hmm. reduce the cap.
Okay, thank you, that's
second.
My motion.
Second from Mr. Robinson, any comments or? All right, we're ready for a vote. All those in favor of the proposed amendment, it passes 6-0. I'm going to look to this table for a little bit of help with the final motion of the evening, because I jotted down a number, and I just really, it would be really bad if we voted the wrong number. So.
4919961.
Thank you.
Is that what it is?
I think it would be worth actually walking through for the public and for us. Yeah. So the current superintendent's recommended FY18 budget is $41,301,661. Am I correct? Okay. Mr. Robinson's proposal. Is there any way you could walk me through this, or would you like me to do it? Okay.
If you want, you can just
read it.
So add back. Why don't you do it?
438.
Thank you.
438,000.
Got it.
150,000.
That's raising the fee.
Separate motion?
That's a wash.
That's a wash.
Oh, that's a wash, right?
Right.
But we have
but
to
you
vote
have to raise,
on that.
You have to raise the fee.
I think we should address this completely separately.
Okay.
Yeah.
Don't include this.
Okay. That's fine too. So it's just those two.
It's 566,000.
588,000. 588,000.
588.
Yep.
Okay. And did you add that to the?
It does add up to the 41,889,661.
Can you repeat that, Mrs. Webb?
41,889,661.
Okay. That's 41,889,661. And because I actually would really like us to vote a final number. Yeah. I'm trying to think of how to logistically do this. I'd like to do the kindergarten fee included in. Yeah, I'm going to ask you to add that to your motion. I'm sorry, I know I said I'm changing my mind.
And 50,000 for the kindergarten paraeducators.
to be gotten from raising?
Raised, to be appropriated by raising kindergarten fee.
By $250 per student.
By $250 per student.
And increase the offset.
And increase the offset, use of the offset.
By?
$50,000.
By $50,000, thank you. It was a brutal motion, but it brings us to a total, recommended school committee budget of $41,889,661. Is that the same math everyone else has got?
What was that? What was your?
Mine was $41,889,661.
Thank you.
Is that what you have?
Yes, I heard 81 and I lost $40.
Apologies. I think that covers all components of Mr. Robinson's proposal. Any discussion around this? Are we ready for a vote? All those in favor? The motion passes 6-0. At this point, I do not believe we will be having a meeting on Monday night, Dr. Doherty.
Unless you want to all get together.
It's been real, but a night off might do us all some good. Mrs. Webb has a comment.
I just would like to know, what does that make our budget cut? I believe after three times, I got page four, figures three and four, are $288,405. And does that make our cut $700,000 on figure two on page three? I'm just trying to understand what the total is. You're still cutting the parents, educators, or even. That comes out of the cut.
Can we? We don't need to do that.
We don't need to. All right, I just want to make sure that we're clear. And so, because of the community needs to understand that we're still cutting, I think, almost $1 million.
I get $800,000, yeah.
Nick pointed that out earlier. He went through the.
Motion to adjourn?
Before we move to adjourn, point of privilege of the chair. I really do. We said thank you before, but we need to say thank you again. The amount of work that Dr. Doherty, Gail, Carolyn, Craig, and all the principals put into this was enormous and not easy, and it is very appreciated by the community. The difficult time the staff is going through, we get it, and we know. It is truly a pleasure to work with the five of you. So thank you for your hard work on this. I'd also like to thank the unprecedented number of community members who have come out over the last month to advocate, to share your ideas. That's been very helpful. And teachers, of course, the whole community. The final thing I'd like to say, and I think Mr. Robin has a comment, is what I learned from this experience, this budget, is the problem of a $1.4 million deficit is not a problem that can be solved by the school committee. It's clearly not a problem that can be solved by the administration, and it can't be solved by the school committee. We really are going to need some community support to get out of the precarious situation our schools are in.
I wanted to thank everybody that I've had the privilege of serving with, and I mean that everyone at this table, very hardworking, very thoughtful, exceptional number of hours, but I also wanted to thank the people that are not here. Each of us has friends, family, loved ones who have not seen us in a very long time. And for those people, if they're still up, thank you. Enormous sacrifices that you made for us to do this and serve the community. Thank you all.
You're right, Mr. Bovin. And with that, do I hear a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? 6-0. We're adjourned.